I call this meeting the Williamsburg James City County School Board to order. I'm going to have to be careful how loud I speak into that mic. It's pretty loud. We are not going to certify closed session because we are going to go into closed session after we are done with open session tonight. Ms. Serza, could you take the roll, please?
Ms. Cook?
Here.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Here.
Ms. Emanuel?
Here.
Mr. Fuentes?
Here.
Ms. Larson?
Here.
Mr. Nichols?
Here.
Mr. Kelly?
Here. Thank you. 4.01, approval of the agenda. Can I get a...
Mr. Chairman, I move the approval of the agenda.
Thank you, Ms. Emanuel. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel? Mr. Fuentes?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 5.01, announcement of superintendent's report. Dr. Constantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. In light of tonight's agenda, I'd just like to say a very happy holiday to all of our staff, our students, our family, and our community. I wish you a peaceful and joyful and safe holiday season. That concludes my announcements, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Are there any announcements from board members?
Just have one quick announcement.
Ms. Larson?
Thank you. I just want to, last week, President Obama signed the Every Student Succeeds Act, something that the reauthorization of No Child Left Behind with several changes, pushing more control back down to the state. And just want to thank the several members of this board that have gone to both Richmond and Washington to really pursue the reauthorization of that act. And I think that, you know, that is in no small part due to the work that was done by this delegation and the one from Virginia. Virginia had the largest delegation of people, and we were lucky that Senator Alexander brought in both Senator Kaine and Warner to work with him on the Senate side. And then Ms. Emanuel always had a good relationship with Representative Scott. And so I just want to thank you all, and I'm glad I got to see that before I left the school board service.
I was thinking the same thing.
So.
Any other announcements from school board members? No, that there have been lots of activities at the schools. I know Mrs. Cardasco and I attended play at Jamestown. It's a Wonderful Life, which was very well done. There's also been concerts at War Hill and other places that where our students put on their talents out for recognition. So any other announcements? Moving on to 6.01, board recognitions.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Tonight we have a few recognitions. For the second year in a row, the War Hill girls volleyball team is the VHSL 3A girls volleyball state champion. Way to go. I would like to invite to the podium head coach Greg Kuhn. He would come forward and announce the team members, and then students, please join us up front when your name is called, and do remain for a group photo. Coach?
Ladies, when I read your name, just come on up. Corey Clifton. Hannah Cormier. Ayanna Etter. Ayanna's not here. Allison Faber. Samantha Lambert. Nicole Mulligan. Alexis Pollard. Alexis in here. Elise Ripchick. Gabby Santana. Jesus. Tufte. And Chloe Wilmoth.
We also have several individuals from Jamestown's volleyball team who earned state recognition. Students, as your name is called, please come up front and remain two for a group photo. Two students were named to the Virginia High School League First Team All-State Volleyball. Maria Esch is also a Region 4A East and Conference 18 Player of the Year, and Ellie Papelka. Maria and Ellie, are you here? Come on up. Also, Jen Allison and Emma Schreiner were named to the All-State Volleyball Second Team. Jen and Emma, are you here? And lastly, the Jamestown High School volleyball coach, Tom Stevenson, was named 4A State Co-Coach of the Year. Coach. Great job to our Jamestown students. One more round of applause for everybody. Mr. Chair, we'll have more recognitions at the regular meeting in January.
You can stay. Thank you, Dr. Constantino. Tonight's kind of a special night for us. We bid adieu to four school board members who have provided exceptional service to this school system, this community, and actually to public education all across the Commonwealth. These four individuals have set a high standard for what public service is and what public service means. It's been my pleasure to work and serve with them, and while I wish them well, I will miss them, and they will be missed. So we're going to do this in inverse order of service. Mrs. Emanuel, you're good for a while. No, you're staying. You're the last.
Oh, inverse.
Longevity.
The first one is Heather Cordasco. Ms. Cordasco. It's been my pleasure to serve with Heather these past 4 years, and it was my pleasure, and I was very pleased when she agreed to be the vice chair this year. Heather has been an exceptional board member and has been active in the schools, prepared, engaged, and a very thoughtful board member. I admire the strength of your convictions, and we have shared more than a few laughs with our similar senses of humor. I've had the opportunity to present and speak at a number of gatherings and occasions during my tenure on the school board and in my professional career, but I can't think of many, if any, that mean more to me than giving the Eagle Scout charge at your son's court of honor. So for that, I thank you for that opportunity. I thank you for your service on the board and as vice chair, and you will be missed. Next would be Mr. Nichols. Jim Nichols was chair of the school board during my first 2 years on the board. He reinforced to me the benefits of process, particularly in the development of the SOP and other processes which Jim has been engaged in. And in addition, Jim has been instrumental to the development of the professional workings of this board during his tenure. He emphasized the importance of relationships and getting to know people you work with on a more personal level by breaking bread, sharing a glass of wine, and meeting our families and our spouses and those who are important to us. So all these things he facilitated, and he has had a tremendous amount to do with the working relationships of this board. So, Mr. Nichols, thank you. Ruth. There's no one in WJCC, no one in this community, and very few across the Commonwealth who have advocated for public education more than Ruth Larson. Ruth has been always known for her passion. Ruth has always considered the emotions and feelings of those impacted by her decisions and by the school board's decisions. But what has impressed me the most over the many years which I have known Ruth is her personal development from a mother who cared about kids to a state and probably even a national leader in support of public education. I could go on, but you'll be missed on many levels. Thank you for your service to WJCC, to this school board, and to public education in the Commonwealth and the nation. Elise.
This is the inverse, huh?
So, Elise, how long have you been working with WJCC?
How long did I work here?
Yeah.
32 and a half years, and then I had 2 other years in education. So, with the add my school board, it's 46 and a half years.
So Mrs. Emanuel has served public education. Thank you. Mm-hmm. 46 and a half years. I tried to get her to go for 50, but that didn't work. For me to talk about all the roles that she has had, the causes she has served, the lives she has touched, the impacts to this community would be a fool's errand. There's just too many of them. So, Elise has always been a staunch supporter of teachers and retirees. Elise has been a treasure trove of information and history of WJCC and the things of how things are, how they came to be. One of my most favorite stories with Elise is when we were at the Virginia School Boards Conference, and they were giving a standing ovation to members who had served longer than 25 years. And so everybody was standing up, and Lisa's like, I'm not standing up. They're crazy.
That's on the school board, though.
Yeah, it's on the school board, correct.
I get the whole thing.
Yeah, so 25 years on the school board is too much. But thank you, Elise, for your service and for everything you have done for WJCC, for school children, and all the lives you've touched. It's just, it's unbelievable.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kelly.
That brings us to 7.01, citizens' comments. Mr. Nichols.
For the last time. Is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the school board. Those citizens desiring to speak have, I hope, submitted a speaker's card to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. When a speaker's name is called, the speaker comes to the podium and states his or her name for the record and directs his or her comments to the chair of the board. In order to promote a listening and respectful environment, please avoid applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstration when the speaker is addressing the school board. Personnel matters are not considered in public meetings. The school board requests that all speakers refrain from making any reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. The school board's role is to listen to the speaker rather than to respond to his or her comments. Each speaker is allotted 3 minutes to make his or her comments. The school board asks each speaker to respect this time limitation. Time may not be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated.
Thank you. Mrs. Cordasco?
Do you want this?
We have 18 cards, so I might encourage if you actually can do less than 3 minutes, that might, we normally set aside 30 minutes, so that might allow everybody to get theirs in. So, Amelie Drake?
As you said, I'm Amelie Drake, and I'm representing your local education association tonight. It's my honor to fill in for Kim as we present you with some student artwork, and it's my double honor to present artwork that my own students made tonight. I can tell you, they always put a lot of effort into their artwork, but when they're making it for someone else, you won't believe the amount of time and commitment they put in. So please understand, these are truly from the heart. When I was talking to my students about all the decisions and rules that you make and all the things that you're responsible for, the question of snow days came up. We did choose to make you a nice snow day picture, including some of our favorite activities, which was sticking our tongues out and catching snowflakes.
And I won't tell you that one of the board members said, is mine the only one that has the tongue sticking out?
No, they're sticking out at all of you. The kids really enjoyed this, but they would like to remind you that they would like lots of snow days and the rumors are that this year will be worse than the last 2 years, so I have a feeling they're going to get their wish. But we really appreciate it, and we wanted to present you with some of their artwork. I'm also here tonight to thank the four of you that will no longer be with us after next month. We really appreciate your service. I know sometimes it's a thankless job. It's always a time-consuming job. But no decision that you guys make is a light decision, and we recognize that. We really, really greatly appreciate the time and service you've given to our division and our students. So thank you.
Thank you.
Just clarification, I'm not planning on dying. I just won't be up here.
But you're
going to
enjoy your snow day.
Rob Larson.
He looks vaguely familiar.
Rob Larson. My mom, Ruth Larson, has been on the board for 12 years. 13, 14 years, long as I can remember.
10 years.
Seems like forever. I didn't really write anything. This is kind of on a whim. But I just want to say thank you to my mother and everybody else that's on the school board. I've met some incredible people going back 10 years that I consider lifelong friends now. That are twice my age, you know, a third of my age. I'm old now. But really, going to the school, the snow day things, with your mom's on school board, you get texts all night. Is your mom canceled school? Tell your mom to cancel school. Hey, is your mom canceled school? And I'm like, guys, I was like, it's not her call, but I'll tell her. You know? But really, I just want to say thank you to my mom. You're an inspiration to me, you and dad both. And thank you to everybody else for everything. So, good
thank
luck.
You, Rob. Thanks, Rob.
Christy Tyrone.
Hi, I'm Christine Tyrone, and on a more serious note, I'm here as an individual and a parent of three children in James City County and also the chair of SEAC. This evening, you all will be, I think, voting on the restraint and seclusion policy, and I just wanted to say that I appreciate the fact that we're putting a policy in place. And I appreciate that there have been several revisions and that some of the comments that SEAC have made and recommendations that have been made have been taken into consideration. But one of the things that I wanted to point out, which is our, I believe, CX failure to communicate exactly what our true concern was, and the concern that we have at the root of it all is that the VSBA was used as the governing document template in which we created this and drafted this policy. And in the summer, this past summer, there was legislation that was passed that said, in effect, that the VSBA should not be used any longer. It should be, there were different documents that should be used as the guiding principles, because the Commission of Youth had done a study and found that there were significant problems with that document. And so I invite you as a parent and as the chair of SEAC to please take into consideration that document doesn't represent where the state of Virginia is going with restraint and seclusion. And really, that's all I have to say. I know we've had several comments from people about this. One of the things I just want to point out is that those comments that have come into you are directly related to the problems that the Commission of Youth found with the VSBA to begin with. So the issues that we bring to you are the very issues that prompted this legislation to pass. And I believe those documents have been forwarded. If you would like, I can lead you to those links so that you might be able to review them yourselves and see exactly what we're talking about. And that's all I have to say tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Jennifer Heidel.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Heidel. I'm also a parent of students here in the district, and I'm on the SEAC as well. And I won't be repetitious and redundant and take more than 3 minutes tonight. But I just wanted to, again, bring up the mechanical restraint portion of this policy. And rather than use my own sometimes emotional words, I'd just like to use the words from the U.S. Department of Education Restraint and Seclusion Resource Document. On page 2, it says, and I quote, "Schools should never use mechanical restraints to restrict a child's freedom of movement." On page 10, they define mechanical restraint as any device that restricts movement, and they say that it does not include some of the devices that we previously discussed at the meeting. So it excludes all medical devices. On page 12, it's repeated again as the second of the 15 principles that guide the U.S. Department of Education document. And then on page 27, it shows a study that says mechanical restraints are strictly prohibited. Thank you.
Jennifer Jenkins.
Good evening. My name is Jennifer Jenkins, and I'm here on behalf of my husband, Dr. Todd Jenkins, myself, and my children who attend WJCC schools. As an educator with a master's in school counseling and a master's in business administration, I'm familiar with school policies and the good and bad that come with these policies. Specifically, I'm here tonight to express concern over the current restraint and seclusion policy of WJCC schools. The current policy as written is vague and allows for the use of restraint and seclusion in non-emergency situations. As parents of special needs children and as an educator, this is inexcusable. Restraint and seclusion methods should be reserved for situations that are considered imminent danger of serious physical harm to self or others, not as a means to control behavior deemed inappropriate. Again, as an educator, I do understand the purpose for policy to protect school staff and students. However, the following points are not valid for the current policy and should be immediately removed. Number 1, as needed to quell a disturbance. Number 2, to direct the movement or actions of a student to avoid the undue or deliberate disruption of the learning environment. These points are behavior-driven and should be addressed through de-escalation techniques by teachers, therapists, or administration as needed. Policies are written with the best interest of the students, teachers, and staff. With that being said, restraint and seclusion is detrimental and should not be used haphazardly, as the current policy allows. If no imminent danger exists, restraint and seclusion should not be used as a method of discipline or to stop behaviors. Educators are trained to handle classroom management. Special educators and therapists are trained to not only handle classroom management, but also to understand behaviors that may occur due to disabilities and that may disturb the educational environment. As an educator, I cannot imagine having to contact parents to inform them that their child has been restrained due to a deliberate disturbance. As a parent, I would be horrified to get this call, knowing that my student, my own student, does have behavior issues that can be addressed and handled appropriately and safely without restraint or seclusion. Please consider the vague points in this policy and make the appropriate changes to serve all students and staff. Thank you for your time and consideration. Dr. Todd and Jennifer Jenkins.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bridget Claycomb.
Good evening. My name is Bridget Claycomb. I'm the secretary for SEAC. I'm speaking to reiterate that the use of Virginia School Boards Association's policy as the model for Williamsburg-James City County's restraint and seclusion policy is inappropriate, as it allows for restraint and seclusion in non-emergency situations. This summer, the House and Senate passed a law instructing the Virginia Board of Education to adopt regulations on the use of restraint and seclusion that are consistent with the guidelines for the development of policies and procedures for managing student behavior in emergency situations. That's the Virginia Department of Education's guidance document on restraint and seclusion, and the U.S. Department of Education's resource document on restraint and seclusion. And they did this after they heard the report from the Virginia Commission on Youth that did research and made recommendations regarding restraint and seclusion in Virginia public schools. In its recommendations, the commission reported concerns with the Virginia School Board Association's policy, specifically that the policy is used to quell a disturbance, it's used to prevent the destruction of property, it lacks follow-up procedures, and lacks timely notification to parents. The commission included that the Virginia School Board Association representatives defended their policy on the grounds that there are no federal or state law that prohibits the use of restraint and seclusion to maintain order. However, we know now that the legislature just instructed the Board of Education to create regulations that follow the state and federal guidance documents. These guidance documents specifically say that restraint and seclusion should only be used in emergency situations and should not be used to maintain order or manage behavior. Adopting the Virginia School Board Association's model might have made sense back in 2010 when they wrote it. It was the only real model that school divisions had, and at the time, there were very few divisions who had adopted any written policy. But now, very soon, we're going to have the Board of Education making regulations that are based on those federal and state guidance documents. So I would encourage the division to look at the Virginia state guidance document, as it has a model policy in its Appendix C. And I ask at the very least that the draft policy we currently have and that you're voting on tonight, we strike the language that conflicts with the state and federal guidance documents, specifically that restraint and seclusion is allowed to quell a disturbance and to protect the destruction of property. These are non-emergency situations. If we don't make these corrections now, we're just going to have to make them once the regulations come down. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, Kathy Woolham.
Good evening. This has been quite a journey. Since my last request on behalf of Lafayette High School that the need for equity among high school facilities be incorporated into the CIP, the Lafayette High School advocacy team has done a lot of work. We've researched the history of those needs, past CIPs, as well as the budget process overall. We've had good conversations with members of the school board, the county, central office personnel, and concerned members of the community. It is impossible to impart to you in 3 minutes all the knowledge, ideas, and creative solutions that we have gathered, including those that apply to our award-winning theater department that we have gathered can be applied under the operations budget. The early part of this insight you can find in my November 23rd letter to the school board that outlines the history of the needs and relevant safety concerns. We are convinced more than ever that the need for an auxiliary gym, the walkway to War Hill Sports Complex, and lighting for our fields are not just long overdue, but necessary now for the safety of our students. Thus, we are requesting their inclusion in the fiscal year 2017 CIP. There also appears to be a need for more analysis and validation of data. For example, have we considered all the possible funds that could be used to solve these issues? How does a bridge that was in past budgets for approximately $100,000 jump to $300,000 and then close to $1 million? This requires further analysis. How is traversing alongside a busy road, Long Hill, outside of Lafayette, that is already currently the subject of safety concerns and traffic needs for our student drivers, how is that a safe route as an alternative to War Hill? And while it would certainly be helpful, it is helpful to have independent studies such as this one, the report of facilities condition and education adequacy assessment that clearly defines Lafayette as a lower score than our relative high schools. We are also encouraging more data analysis on the data that was put into this study because we have found some inconsistencies and potential inaccuracies. Let's work collaboratively and from the same set of facts. Let's all work together to be part of the solution in the best interest of our community. Please know we understand the school board's challenge to meet the needs of the entire district. We simply ask that you consider this. Every student in this district is slated to attend one of our three high schools. Are we giving each of them an equal opportunity for success and a strong launch to their future? We appreciate the need to get this right. With the composition of the board changing in just 15 days,
thank you, Mrs. Willen.
Postponing a vote may be helpful and understandable. Thank you.
Thank you.
Susan Barton.
Good evening. Although I've written all of you a personal note, I'm here tonight in my role as the vice president of the Lafayette High School PTSA. Our president, Lisa Lucas, was unable to attend, so I've been asked to read the letter that she had sent earlier to each one of you on behalf of the 150-plus members of the LHS PTSA. Dear WJCC school board members, we need your help. The CIP currently does not include three key long-standing projects for Lafayette High School that are necessary for equity within the WJCC district. All of the following have been included in past budgets for LHS, but never implemented. Number one, the long-standing need for a legitimate and essential auxiliary gym for both regular school classes and after-school practices. Number two, the need for a walkway from LHS to the county's War Hill Sports Complex fields that ensure the safety of our students. Number three, the lack of lighting on LHS practice fields on campus, which both Jamestown High School and War Hill High School have for their students. The Lafayette High School community respectfully asks that you add these items to the 2016 CIP. The student population of Lafayette High School is the second largest in our district. Yet our school has the least square footage per student. Take into account two programs currently housed at LHS, CDR and the Program for At-Risk Students. Neither offer any direct educational benefit to LHS students and cannot be counted as beneficial space. Please note nearly half of our sports teams must travel off campus for games and practices. This creates unnecessary risks to our students, additional time away from their studies due to travel and late practice times, a logistical burden on parents, an inconsistent environment for activities to take place, and additional transportation fuel costs paid by taxpayer dollars. Additionally, the pending demolition of the James Blair facility will create an even greater problem for our programs at LHS because we depend on that gym space regularly. As the high school in the district with the highest population of free and reduced lunch, it is important that the WJCC school district demonstrate its support for all students in our community and maintain equity among all three high schools. Our active and involved RAM community is rallying in support of these essential Lafayette High School needs. As one of you pointed out in the November 17th school board meeting, the quality of sports and arts matter in a community and impact how that community attracts people to it. The Williamsburg community wins when all of our schools receive the attention that is needed to ensure their success. Sincerely, Lisa Lucas, LHS PTSA President.
Thank you, Mrs. Bard.
Matt King.
Good evening. I'm Matt Keane. I'm currently a freshman at William & Mary right now, but for the past 4 years I've played varsity baseball at Lafayette High School. And again, I want to touch on the equity differences between Lafayette, Jamestown, and Warhill High School. To start with, the indoor facility, we used to use James Blair, us, softball team, and various other sports. When weather permitted, we weren't allowed on our field. Well, not really our field, but the county's field. And no longer will we be able to go inside and access that. So we need some sort of indoor facility like Jamestown and Warhill have that we could use over the winter and fall seasons. Another issue is indoor dugouts. It's both Jamestown, actually every single school in the Bay Rivers district that we play has an indoor dugout. Ours could be considered sheltered, but the chain link around it, water seeps into it, has destroyed a couple of my equipment, actually, my catcher's gear, and that's a safety issue. There's not even enough seats in our dugout to sit down in the first place, and we're not asking for nothing big, but just something to keep our gear dry. And then finally, the walkway to the fields. I know me and numerous friends actually had to have a designated pair of shoes to go through there, walking through the swamp while carrying our gear in order to get to practice on time, because our practice is at 3 o'clock, we get out of school at 2:20. It's just the simplest route. Going around takes nearly half an hour up Long Hill Road, unless we're running. We get enough of that at practice. And we just like to see some equality here. I mean, we did win the state championship last year. Given these conditions that aren't exactly as fair, it seems like every year we come out almost underdog because we just don't have the resources or facilities that other schools have. And we just like a fair opportunity at things. Thank you.
John Keane.
I'm John Keane, Matt's dad. I've watched Lafayette baseball for 4 years now play against some really quality teams in the Bay Rivers. Each one of those teams have their own fields with really great facilities. 4 years ago, I went to the rec department along with Alan Robinson, I believe, works for the school board, James City County Schools, Dan Barner, Lafayette athletic director and such, and the coach mentioned two items that were, I think, safety issues at the Warhill Field number 5. One being the fact that the fences along the sidelines protecting the seating areas weren't high enough. Errant throws, balls being hit, somebody talking to a person in the stands all of a sudden is getting a baseball whizzed by his head. County was good enough right away to raise those fences up. What they still haven't addressed, though, is the fact that our Lafayette baseball team plays in that field. The backstop behind it is an open chain link fence with the parking lot right behind it. Okay, when those cars pull into the parking lot, shining their lights onto the field, there's a high school pitcher on that field from any one of eight different schools in the county, in the Bay Rivers, throwing a baseball 56 feet away. Those balls being hit back at a projected rate over 100 miles an hour back of those people. And I've talked to these kids, everyone from J.T. Kastner to previous Jamestown players and Warhill players, saying that they can't see the baseball sometimes coming back at them. Every field in the Bay Rivers has a dark screen on the back a pitcher's protective eye. So at least they can spot the baseball coming at them. It needs to be addressed. It needs to be fixed this year prior to the season. And the county has to, or if you people can find somebody in the capital improvement budget to actually do that. It's a safety issue, and the kids deserve it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Deborah Keane.
Good evening. The Keens have made an entrance. I'm the mother of Matt and the wife of John, and I'm here to address the current inequities in the WJCC school system. Over the past few years, I've had three children attend Lafayette. One graduated in 2012, who played softball, and she had to travel over to the rec center on Long Hill Road to play softball. So these girls used to pile into a car to drive down Long Hill Road to go to practice at the rec center because they didn't have their own field. I have one that graduated in 2015, and we were lucky enough to actually celebrate graduation on the field of Liberty University because Lafayette won states and Mr. Kelly was there. And it was probably the most awesome experience I've ever had in my entire life to celebrate with my children. I have one more left, and he's a junior. He also plays baseball. My fear is that now for 7 years and counting, I have watched Lafayette High School become the orphan child. I have seen our children fight and usually be the last one on the totem pole to receive anything in the line of needs for schools. I know my husband has talked to some of the members of the school board, as well as county supervisors and city councilmen about the adverse conditions that our baseball players have to deal with. I know this is the same for other sports, and I wonder why. We've traveled with our sons during the summer and fall for baseball, and we visit many other schools in the Virginia area, and I cannot even think of one other school that does not have their own baseball field. Lafayette is the only school that I know of in the state of Virginia that I've been to that does not have their own field. Our kids use the county fields that we share with rec ball, travel ball, and legion ball. Our dugouts are embarrassing and not enclosed, so when it rains, the boys' clothes and their equipment get soaking wet. And I don't know if any of you know how much a catcher's gear costs, but at $300 a shot, it's an absolute, it's horrible to a family to lose this. And it's all because nobody wants to enclose these dugouts because no one wants to specify whose they are. Are they the county? Are they the city? Are they the school board? Whose are they? We use them, we borrow them, they're not ours. The boys walk through mud and swamps to get to their borrowed fields. They use the old gym at James Blair for off-season conditionings, but can't even hit baseballs because it scuffs the floor. Now that the school board's decided it's necessary to build a fourth middle school, our only inside practice gym will be torn down. Where is the equity here? Jamestown has two gyms, its own baseball field. Warhill has a state-of-the-art building and a beautiful baseball field. And what does Lafayette have? A borrowed field when it's available and a gym that's going to be torn down. And my time is out, so I can't finish. Thank you.
Jay Everson.
Thank you. Jay Everson, 103 Branscombe Boulevard. And to the four of you who are moving on, good luck. God bless you both. All of you, I should say. I wanted to speak on James Blair. I want to put the James Blair into a little context here. We've just had an election. And in the run-up to that election, there was a forum at the library. And the three men running all supported the existing plan to repurpose James Blair. The three women running, not so much. And in the aftermath of that forum, the Virginia Gazette ran on the front page of the paper an article about why the women basically didn't know what they were talking about. Nevertheless, two of the four women won, going away. And so it seems to me that when you have 40% of James City County who are going to pay 90% of the cost, operational and capital, that we need to pay attention to what voters have said. Now, I know that there's this issue here. I didn't realize the extent of the issue on Lafayette. But it's being closed out, as the woman said, in large part because of James Blair. Now, your future think numbers have come out. And if you go back, and I've given you a packet, if you go back the last 5 years to 2010, 10-year projections in each year, you will see that the growth of the middle school population is moderated to somewhat down. And while we do not know if this is an aberration or a trend, it is clearly a very different situation than it was in 2009 and 2010 when the repurposing of James Blair was first brought forward. Times have changed. And the thing that's really interesting to me is that this is planned to open about 2018. I've included the budget document there, which projects the cost to be $2.7 million, which doesn't include 10 bus drivers, nor does it include utility costs, among other things. That school is going to open up at less than 45% capacity. And in 10 years from now, it will still be only at 80%. Now, it's crowding out other monies for things like Lafayette. But you know, when you have a school that's going to open up in 2018 for 246 over capacity, the annex fits 250. And even with the projections 10 years out for 447 over capacity, the $14 million option to expand the three existing middle schools fits in real well. I would encourage you to keep in mind what the voters have said just a month ago and the things that Lafayette would like to see also. Thank you.
Tinsley Gold.
Bless you. Good evening, Tinsley Goad. I'm speaking in support of the addition to the CIP of the three items proposed for Lafayette High School. I have two recent graduates from Lafayette and have been keenly aware of the limitations of the high school facilities for some time. These specific items have already been mentioned, and so I would like to simply address what I believe to be several misconceptions regarding these items and to point out the persisting imbalance and hence unfairness in the facilities across the division's three schools. With respect to the auxiliary gym request, despite the characterization by some, the room at LHS that currently serves as the weight room can in no way be considered an auxiliary gym. It is approximately one quarter the floor space of the main gym, and the ceiling is less than half the height. I think most people would agree to a definition of an auxiliary gym as a facility where sports that typically play their competitive games inside could conduct practice in a regular standard environment. This is simply not the case for the weight room at LHS due to its size and height constraints. It has been noted elsewhere that Jamestown High School has a full auxiliary gym, and that while War Hill does not have a separate space, their gym can in fact be divided in two by a central curtain and be rendered into two full-size gyms crossways. The main LHS gym is not large enough to employ this solution, and so LHS has one and only one gym that can support a full-size volleyball or basketball court. I would label this as unfair. With respect to the upgraded pathway request, while there is in fact an alternative walking route, as has been discussed, down Long Hill Road and across the WISC entrance trail, that route is not only three times the distance of the proposed walkway, but also requires students to cross two lanes of traffic and the busy WISC intersection. Indeed, an LHS track athlete was struck by a vehicle at that intersection several years ago. And even now, the cross-country team does not use that route for practice out of safety concerns. During the last redistricting process, it was noted by several members that WJCC's goal was to render irrelevant the particular district in which a student is resided. All elementary, middle, and high school experiences would be equivalent no matter your street address. Any casual observer, and I invite the board to become a casual observer at least of these facilities, any casual observer comparing these facilities would be hard-pressed to draw the conclusion that any such equity exists today. I implore the board to adopt a CIP that addresses these inequities and facility needs as soon as possible. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ryan Irwin.
Good evening. My name is Brian Irwin. I'm a resident of James City County, and I just wanted to speak for the behalf of my children. One has recently graduated, and I've got a son that's currently a sophomore at Lafayette. So I'm a proud parent of Lafayette, and I come tonight to represent not only my children, but over 500 people that have signed this petition, stating the inadequacy that exists currently at Lafayette. I could go on and speak about the other, how it's unbalanced, but I would just ask the group that before you vote and authorize on a fourth middle school, a new administrative building. I've heard rumors that there's potentially turf and light fields at Jamestown High School, Jamestown High School. I'd just like to ask the board to live up to your previous commitments that have been turned down through budget cuts. We simply ask to be equal to the other two schools, and that's simply what we want to do. So we want to right the wrong and do what's right. So who can I give this to? Thank you.
Thank
Dave
you.
Jarman.
Hello, I'm Dave Jarman. I live in the Berkeley District of James City County. Last Friday, I sent each of you, plus the four new members, plus the media and Dr. Constantino, a detailed report addressing the school CIP. It runs about 10 minutes. I will try to do it in less than that. I'd like to make three key points. First, the 188-page report that you received, the facility study from Faithful and Gold, is a major step forward in restructuring how the school division manages its facilities. This is to be applauded. Dr. Constantino, in particular, for authorizing it, is to be applauded. This is very important, as the school division encompasses some two-thirds of the overall county capital spending. The second point I want to make is that as part of what you're going to be voting on today, the administration has created a 10-year facilities plan. For this county and city, this is groundbreaking. It brings the school district in line with what certain neighboring districts, such as your county and Isle of Wight County, have done. They've been preparing 10-year facilities plans for some time. It is also interesting that it is a key component in supporting the county's strategic planning process, which envisions a countywide 10-year facilities plan as a key component of the strategic planning process. That is underway, will be completed, and I believe voted on in October of next year. And finally, it establishes a more effective scheduling of the planning components of the long-term capital plan, separate from the preparation of the operating budget, your one-year operating budget. I have 1 minute. Let me speak to one of the seven questions that I asked in that detailed report I sent you. The design for the new middle school, it is truly revolutionary. I believe you're going to hear more about it later this evening. There are reasonable questions that one could ask as to how successful this new programmatic approach will work for us locally. Thinking long-term, introduction of this new program methodology in the facilities for the middle schools across the system raises questions of how the existing facilities will handle this new approach. I don't see in the 10-year facilities plan any specifics with regards to how the other three schools will be handling this. 3, 2, 1. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jarman.
Jennifer Cottrell.
Good evening, Dr. Constantino and members of the school board. Thank you all for providing this open forum. I'm here as a proud Lafayette Theater parent. I want to reiterate just a couple things I put in the letter that I sent all of you, and thank you for those of you who responded. I'm sorry to hear that some of you who said you'd be looking into it aren't going to be here in your positions anymore, so I hope that people do look into that further. I'm here to talk about something a little different tonight. But as I said in the letter, Lafayette High School Theater ranks top in the state. We, for the ninth year in a row, we went to the state championship, which is the top four. This year we came home with another first place championship. And I want to thank you all for whoever was in charge of putting that congratulatory picture on the James City County School website for acknowledging their hard work. Our kids at Lafayette have been successful despite the lack and loss of significant storage space at the school for set building, materials, props, and costumes. The designated 900 storage space is inadequate. It can hold some props, but there's no space for creating and building sets. There's no room for costumes. We need an area set aside for Lafayette High School Theater Department tech room, as other schools in the district have. We need an area that will accommodate a safe place for our students and parents to create, build, and store theater materials. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Is that bringing us to an end? Thank you, everyone, for your comments, and your input is always considered by the board. 8.01, information items, audit report for the year ended June 30th, 2015. Dr. Constantino.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, a yearly presentation of the independent auditor's report for fiscal year ending June 30th, 2015. Ms. Berta will introduce our speaker this evening.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. It's my honor to introduce you to Leslie Roberts, a partner with Dixon Hughes Goodman, who did our external audit. She will give you more information.
Thank you.
So excited about the financial statement presentation. good evening. My name is Leslie Roberts. I had the pleasure of supervising your audit for the first time this year. Worked with the county for several years, but this is the first time I've been involved with the schools. As far as the audit went, I'm just going to kind of give you the high notes, and then Rob's going to come in and give some details. But the field work went fine. We were able to come in here and do our field work when we were scheduled, and everybody was ready for our field work and was accommodating throughout it. The wrap-up of the audit went on for some time, and that dragged out a bit. A lot of that was out of the control of us or your staff. It related to the new GASB, which Rob will talk more about. We were waiting for some information from BRS and the APA in order to make some last-minute entries, which were very substantial to your financial statements. We worked through that, and hopefully we'll be able to streamline things going forward, and of course we won't have that huge new GASB to implement. As far as the detail from the audit and going through part of your CAFR, Rob Oden, who you're familiar with, the senior manager on the job, is going to do that. We've also got Brittany Gregerson here, who is the in charge on your job. So between the three of us, hopefully we can answer all of your questions. Thank you.
Honorable school board members, it's a pleasure to be with you again tonight this year to present to you the comprehensive annual financial report for the school board and the financial statements for the activity funds and our audit reports that are included therein for the fiscal year ended June 30, 2015. Now, as we've discussed in the past, this CAFR, this financial statement, keeps growing in size every year. I think last year was 116 pages, now it's up to 132. Mostly due to the new GASB that Leslie mentioned, GASB 60, which we'll get into in detail. So to give you a little bit of insight into the structure and makeup of this document so you can focus your review, I wanted to give you just a few highlights on or a roadmap in reviewing this. On pages 3 through 8, there's a letter of transmittal from the management of the school board to the school board members and to the community to discuss some financial and non-financial metrics of the school board, the pupil successes for the year and rankings and SOL scores, etc. On pages 13 through 23 is the management discussion and analysis. Again, this is your executive summary, if you will. This is where you've got year-over-year comparison of financial data in a summarized manner, so you don't have to dig through the other 132 pages to find what you're looking for. If you spend any time in these financials, I would suggest focusing your attention or starting your attention on the management discussion and analysis. Pages 27 through 81 are the financial statements, the related footnotes, and some supplementary information. And 85 through 130 are the statistical section, which are required to be included and provide 10-year historical trend data on cost per pupil, economic data of James City County and what City of Williamsburg, and financial statement information accumulated in other parts of the CAFR. Now, I would like to point out, and I'm pleased to point out, on pages 9 and 10 of the CAFR, the school board has again received their Certificate of Excellence in Financial Reporting from the Association of School Board Business Officers and from the Governmental Finance Officers Association. So congratulations on the preparers of this CAFR to receive that. That is based on the fiscal year 14 CAFR. Based on our review of this and the audit of these numbers and the format and presentation of this document, we have no reason to believe that this document for fiscal year 15 won't also receive those same awards. Now, in the CAFR, there's only two parts of the financial statements that belong to Dixon Hughes Goodman, and those are our audit reports. The first one is on page 11 and 12. Page 11 and 12 are the independent auditor's report, and this goes through and defines management's responsibility in the audit process and the auditor's responsibility in the audit process, and also what you guys care about, the opinion paragraph. I'm pleased to report we are expressing an unmodified opinion on these financial statements. This is the highest level of assurance the CPA can give on a set of financial statements. It means that this financial statement is presented fairly in all material respects in accordance with generally accepted accounting principles. Now, as Leslie mentioned, on page 11, there is a significant new GASB or GASBs this year. They kind of pair together, GASB 68 and 71. And this emphasis of matters paragraph is to draw the user of the financials' attention to the footnotes and the changes in the financial statements that we'll discuss here. The second audit report is in the very back, pages 131 and 132. And this is our report on internal controls over financial reporting and on compliance and other matters and required with governmental auditing standards. And I'm pleased to report that in this report we state there are no instances of non-compliance and no internal control deficiencies that are required to be reported to you. Now, as we work through the financials, I won't go into great detail unless anybody has specific questions, but there are a few additional footnotes and areas in the financial statements I would like to point out for changes from this GASB 68. Overall, GASB 68 and 71 go together, and basically the basics of these are that you've got your Virginia Retirement System pension plans, defined benefit pension plans, for the teachers and your non-professional staff at the school board. In the past, they're assets held in trust, and they're also actuarially determined liabilities for these defined benefit pension plans, that net pension benefit obligation has never been required to be reported in these financials. GASB 68 brings that requirement into these financial statements in fiscal year 15. So if you turn with me to page 27, the statement of net position governmental activities, in the liability section, right down the last liability, right above total liabilities, is a net pension liability of $103.1 million. That is the actuarial determined underfunded status of the teacher and non-professional plans at this date. There are some footnotes that go along.
May I ask a question?
Yes, sir.
You say the underfunded, you're saying underfunded by VRS, right?
Underfunded by the localities, but there are the actuarial required contributions annually that are required for the school board to make are not underfunded. The school board is making all of the required contributions. This is just at a point in time, June 30th, 15, the projected liabilities exceed the projected assets. And so this is going to be made up through future increases in the required contributions. So this is where you are now, but there are plans in place with VRS and actuaries that help the VRS to determine your required contributions annually to keep this on pace so that pension funds are there when people need them.
This would be every division has the same situation, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
And I just want to make sure I understand.
thought that the VRS was responsible for the annuity or, you know, the pension plan, right?
VRS runs the pension plan, administers the plan, yes, sir.
Correct, and we give into it, but we give into the plan, we pay into the plan, mm-hmm. and they're underfunded right now, correct?
They're underfunded, yes.
Right, so we
and your share of that underfunded status is like 0.86%. So that's where you get the $103 million is the state-level teacher fund is underfunded, and 0.86% of that is the $103 million that you're seeing here. That's your share of that overall underfunded status.
That's underfunded.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you.
There are footnotes as well that give a little more detail of this new GASB. On page 36 at the bottom, it talks about the new accounting standard, GASB 68 and 71, and how those work together, and kind of talk a little bit more detail about the underfunded status I just mentioned. The largest footnote in the financial statements, footnote 6, which begins on 47, gives significant detail about the Virginia retirement system and the three plans, the Plan 1, the Plan 2, and the hybrid plan. And as you turn towards the end of that, there is information that shows the breakdown between the two plans, the teacher plan and the non-professional plan. While the teacher plan is at an underfunded status of $103 million, the non-professional plan is actually at an asset position of $800,000. Now, to show you the volatility in some of these numbers, and just to reinforce the fact that these are estimates, not only the projected assets, but also the projected obligation. Turn with me to page 65, and there's a table on 65 that gives a little more information. So the sensitivity of the school division's proportionate share of the net pension liability to changes in the discount rate. And the discount rate is similar to the investment rate of return that actuaries would use to estimate the value of the money in the future. So a 1% decrease in the discount rate would actually increase your liability by close to $50 million, and a 1% increase in the discount rate would lower your liability by about $40 million. So you can see the volatility in the estimates by a 1% change in the discount rate. Also on page 71, footnote number 12, this GASB required a retrospective adjustment, meaning that when you implement in fiscal year 15, you also have to go back and change fiscal year 14's numbers to reflect that if this GASB had been implemented in fiscal year 14, this is what the impact would have been. And so in these statements, anywhere where you see reference to fiscal year 14, those numbers have been restated for retrospectively implementing this new GASB. Also a new footnote, number 11, on related organizations. It talks about the Williamsburg James City County School Board's relationship with various organizations in the community, and most significantly, the New Horizons Education Center and the amount of funds that James City County has contributed to New Horizons for fiscal year 15. Also, as part of your package, I believe you have received also our management letter, which is a letter to those charged with governance. I'm not going to go in detail on that. The only thing that's out of the ordinary or different from previous years is the emphasis on the new GASBs that I just discussed. Also, with regard to the review of the activity funds or the audit of the activity fund financial statements, we go out to every single school, all 15 schools, and we work with the bookkeepers and the principals, and we look through cash receipts, cash disbursements to make sure all policies and procedures are being followed. And then we issue our audit opinion on those financial statements. And I'm pleased to report that we issued an unmodified opinion on that statement as well. And that report was issued October 1st, and I believe it's in your package as well. With regard to that audit, we also issued a management letter. And in that management letter, we discussed the control deficiencies at the schools. And overall, there's consistently the same control deficiency, a significant deficiency on segregation of duties, where the bookkeeper is in charge of processing all cash receipts, taking the money to the bank, recording the transactions in the general ledger. This is something that's not economically feasible to circumvent, but the county has taken, the school board has taken action to have the principal involved in the process and provide those compensating controls to review and approve what the bookkeeper is doing. So that concludes my presentation. If there's any questions, I'd be happy to address them at this time.
Any questions from any board members this evening? Ms. Cook?
I don't have a question, just a comment. On page 94, just wanted to point that out to my colleagues and anybody else who's interested. If you look at the amount of growth in general administrative expenses in the division and then the amount of growth in instruction, it's quite amazing and strikes me that we're putting a lot of resources in the classroom. It's quite an interesting snapshot of the last 10 years.
Thank you. Any other comments from board members? Mr. Fuentes?
A couple comments. Good report. And I noticed, we every year we do have some issues with the with that one report with the schools.
Yes,
There's
sir.
There's always some things there that come up. I saw in general, though, we fared fairly well. There's a couple areas that might need some improvement, and it looks like they have a plan of action to take care of those. This past year, I guess you're familiar, I've been kind of concerned about our related organizations. And there's, I'm trying to understand something. So we've put a foundation into place this last year, and I'm trying to understand why that wouldn't be considered a component unit.
Joe, can you pull that microphone closer to you?
That's my job.
Red light's coming on. Even when I. Why the foundation? I know it's new, but it's based on everything I've read in the Gatsby documents that the foundation meets the criteria for Gatsby 14, I think it is, for...
joint ventures or component
joint
units.
Ventures. No, not joint ventures, excuse me.
Component units.
The foundation.
Yes.
Those generally, and what I've seen in other areas, that they end up being component units. Under Gatsby, I forgot what the other number is. Mm-hmm. There's another number for component units. That's one of my questions.
Sure.
The other one, and the reason, and some of these, the reason why it's concerned is because, I've been on the board like 10 years now, and we got four new members coming on. It's taken a long time to even get visibility, even as my involvement into these. So as a board member, I felt like my feeling is that these things, some of these related organizations should be within the financial statements so that it's understood and at a minimum just for that purpose, but also to fully disclose, as Gatsby 14 kind of indicates, there's a sentence in there that kind of describes it. I can't recall. So anyway, that was one question, the foundation. Then the WHRO, big history there where that's an independent, it's a nonprofit corporation, very unique, worth a lot of money that we own, we're part owners in. However, we as board members have no insight to that owner, to the details of that, and not that I want all the financial details, but I think that the statement that's done on other financial statements that talk about related organizations, why wouldn't that be in there also to show our ownership in the especially in the event that ownership or that nonprofit status may change in the future because of other reasons. And then, of course, I want to address New Horizons separately. Mm-hmm. But
well, in the foundation, it is my understanding from working with Renee and Christina that it was new at the end of the year and was not funded or not materially funded. And so there's not any material numbers that need to be included in your financial statements. That's something we're going to look at very closely next year. I didn't spend a lot of time reviewing that because there was very little impact financially with regard to that during the fiscal year we were auditing. But with regard to fiscal year 16, we'll look very closely at that to make sure it gets presented properly in the right place.
Okay. WHRO, I get it, it's independent, and they have their own financials, and we're shielded because it's an independent corporation, not independent, the nonprofit corporation that we are part owners in it. Should that not also be discussed as a related organization and some of the details of what that is, and then point to where we go look at the financials for it?
It depends on the materiality to whether or not you need to disclose it in the financial statements. With regard to joint ventures and with regard to the specific operating agreements of those joint ventures, whether it be New Horizons or WHRO, most of the time the financial investment in those organizations would be your upfront capital contribution to those organizations. Specifically for New Horizons, we went back.
Let's stay on WHRO first.
Okay.
On that one. And I don't know if that's a joint. In fact, I know that's not a joint venture. It doesn't meet the definition of joint venture. It's jointly governed, but it's not a joint venture.
Well, the amount of money that you're contributing to WHRO could be disclosed in your financial statements if you decided it needed to be there. But from my perspective, from our audit perspective, your financial statements are not materially misstated without that information being in here.
And I guess maybe I'm not even focusing on the amount of money in there. I guess it's the related organizations where I've seen where we describe the relation with that organization.
If the board wants information in their financial statements at that level of detail, they're welcome to put those in here. They're not required to be in here under accounting principles because they don't reach a material level that would misstate the financials without them being in here. So that's the approach. I did not look specifically at WHRO. I looked specifically at New Horizons because of the request that was made. But WHRO, I feel, falls in the same line as New Horizons. And if the amount of contributions to that related or jointly governed organization were significant, then I would advise a footnote in here to disclose the amount of the contributions. But again, as you mentioned, you don't have the rights to the inflows or outflows or the net income or net loss of that organization, those wouldn't be on your financial statements. Specifically, the operating agreement says that cost sharing and profit sharing is not allowed in those agreements.
Which one are we talking about?
I'm jumping back to New Horizons. That's the one I kind of focused on. But
okay, so New Horizons. Okay, since you want to, I still think the other related organizations, any related organization that we are involved with, you know, especially if we are jointly governing something such as WHRO, should be described in here, if nothing else, so that future boards and the citizens know our relationship with it. Because it took a long time for me to understand the whole nonprofit and our relationship with them. And there's still some parts of that I still don't understand. I think Ms. Emanuel has served, and I think Mr. Nichol has served as board members, and we have a seat on that board down there.
Like I said, if you want the voluntary informative disclosure,
sure.
That's completely
now,
fine.
Now, New Horizons, though, is a different issue. That one, I see that as a joint venture, so those are defined as each member has equal. In fact, I read in here it says something about. Let's see. Because I was reading this today, something about we have, it says four other local divisions, but actually there's five other, so there's six owners of New Horizons. So, and we're all six equal owners, defined by the Code of Virginia. And then the Code of Virginia makes it very clear that a vote by that board is the same as a vote by this board. And the other five wards that are on there. So I'm trying to understand why that's not significant.
I think while that is significant, I think that your rights to the assets of that organization would only come if you decided to voluntarily withdraw from that organization. And at that time, there would have to be a fair value determined of the Butler Farm and the Woodside campuses, and those other member organizations would have to kind of buy Williamsburg James City County out. At that time, when the inflow of resources came to the school board, that's when those would be recognized. At this point, if there was an initial investment, then that would be recorded as an asset, as an investment in that organization. But you know, this was entered into almost 40 years ago. I know Renee and Christina looked back at the records and tried to determine if there was evidence of an initial investment in those campuses, and could not determine if there if there was or was not. So that would be the only amount that would be recorded on your financial statements as an asset in that organization until you voluntarily withdraw and exercise that contingency of withdrawing from the organization. At that time, the fair value would be determined.
I understand that. I guess my bigger point is, you know, if you go by the Gatsby rules and everything, joint ventures are supposed to be presented on the financials. So this is the first year we even kind of allude to the New Horizons. So we got it on there. We don't clearly state that it's a joint venture, and we don't describe all about it, and then we don't describe how to go see the financials. And that's, I guess that's where I'm like, why is this different? And, you know, why? What makes this different is what I was trying to understand.
And
it goes to a lot of people have a misunderstanding about New Horizons and our ownership in New Horizons, mm-hmm. the fact that we have, you know, that that is one of our schools that we control and that we, you know, the and all the rules around it. And so there is a financial, I want to use the correct word, but we are vested in that school. We can't just walk away from it. And that's information that I think that the citizens of both Williamsburg and James City County should know. And wouldn't that this be the place, especially when Gatsby does specifically state that it should be in here and that should be described?
Gatsby talks about joint ventures, and we do believe that New Horizons is a joint venture. But again, based on that, the only amount reflected in your financial statements would be the amount of initial investment, because the operating agreement doesn't allow for the share of profits and losses. Again, informative disclosures. You can disclose anything that you as a board and administration feel need to be disclosed. The amount that we felt was materially needed to be included in these financial statements was the amount of current contributions. I believe that, you know, you can withdraw based on my reading. Access to your percentage of the assets, the fair value of those assets at that time. And your only obligation is your obligation for the students that are attending for that year. So I, that's why I don't believe there's any other numbers that need to be in your financial statements regarding that, other than the disclosure of the current year contributions. You know, we looked at this in great detail, and we weighed in with different members of our firm about this. And we also looked at what the other members of the organization are doing, Newport News and Hampton, and discussed with their auditors the similar impact, and also consider what your previous auditors have also required disclosing these financial statements. And I think our opinion is consistent with theirs, that there should be no assets or liabilities recorded unless it was an initial investment, which 40 years ago, we can't determine whether there was or was not. And so then I think all that is required in these financials is the annual contributions to New Horizon. But again, in informative disclosures, you guys can disclose whatever you want in these financial statements. It's just, it's not, these are not materially misstated for this information not being in here. And that's our firm's opinion. I believe other professional service firms' opinion as well.
I guess we can talk with you guys offline.
Sure.
About some of this. It wasn't so much the asset. I'm focusing more on the notes,
mm-hmm.
and I saw what you wrote about that. I think that I'm just saying it might need to be presented differently based on how Gatsby's written and how I've seen joint ventures presented other places. But let me ask you something about Gatsby 68. So the numbers that we present for our that million, whatever that number was, that
yes, sir.
Could fluctuate either way with 1%. Does that roll up to the county, that liability?
Yes.
Okay. So being a joint venture and being that we are owners of that New Horizons, the qualified opinion they had for 3 years was regarding post-employment benefits.
Mm-hmm.
So why would that liability not roll up to us, portion of that liability?
Because they're not a component unit of the school board. And so the component unit of the school board would roll up. And since we've determined through our previous discussion that the assets and liabilities of that organization wouldn't show up on your financial statements, because their financial statements are misstated for not including a certain liability that they should include, doesn't affect your financial statements, because you don't report their liabilities anyway on your balance sheet, your financial statement.
And so I guess that's one area I need to understand. So if they have a liability,
right down there. So they had that liability was for post employment benefits for insurance, and then of course this year will be they'll have the Gatsby 68 liability added to that also.
Yes, sir.
So I guess what I'm trying to figure out, since it's owned by the six divisions, who ends up being responsible for those liabilities?
That's paid for by the contributions for the students attending, and the annual budgets are established to fund those liabilities.
Okay, so then it's treated as an expense.
Yes, on your financial statements, it'd be treated as an expense. In future years, as you pay that contribution to the organization for the number of students attending.
Even though it's a long-term liability?
It's a long-term liability that's going to be paid over a long period of time, and I assume that the governing board of that organization is to go incorporate the settlement of that liability through their annual budgetary process and allocate that down to the member jurisdictions or the members in their annual contributions.
Okay. I'm okay with that, but then that goes back to my point about explaining the joint venture in here that would point back to that financial statement so that all communities, including our appropriating bodies, know that that liability exists down the road. But, all right, I can see that, you know, anyway, that's enough of my questions. Other than that, everything's lovely.
Yeah,
it was good, so thank you.
Mr. Fuentes, we'd be happy to discuss more.
Yeah,
offline.
I'll give you a call and we can talk, and I'll come by and show you what I have that kind of indicates. What I was looking for was somewhat simple anyway. But thank you.
Ms. Emanuel.
Mr. Fuentes, I think you might have misunderstood about WHRO. Only one member of the Heretic Committee, and that's the chairman, sits on the WHRO board. So when you've got a president of the Heretic Committee, they sit on the WHRO board. And I don't know if that's true for the superintendent or not, the superintendent group.
There's one.
Yeah, so there are two educators then on the board during your time on the board.
There's two boards.
I just didn't want you to
No,
say
no,
that.
So that's the part that maybe needs to be explained for us to understand. Maybe doesn't belong on there. I'm trying to understand what our relationship, well, I go back to the part where we are part owners of that, so.
Yes, that's true.
Okay.
It's the only one in the country, so maybe they can't even find out how others do it.
Any other comments from board members about the audit? Thank you, sir, I appreciate it. I appreciate the audit and the results, and I thank Ms. Berta and her staff for the effort it takes to get that. We have a lot of moving parts, particularly when we talk about the schools and all theirs, and so to have as few issues as we have, I think, is exemplary. So thank you.
Thanks. Happy holidays.
Thank you.
Brings us to 8.02, new middle school design development update. Dr. Constantino.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Tonight is a design development update. Prior to this update, you have heard several conceptual designs. This I would characterize as a bridge from concept to reality. The next presentation that you get in January will actually be the 35% design presentation that you require. Our friends from Waller, Todd, and Sadler are here, as well as Fannie Howley, and they have brought other engineers and folks who have worked on several aspects of the middle school design, and they'd like to present that information to you this evening. Are you starting? Are you up, Howard?
Yes, sir.
All right, welcome.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Constantino, glad to be here. Howard Collins with Waller, Todd, and Sadler Architects. And as Dr. Constantino mentioned, this is the design development update for you. The design team members, I've brought some with me. We have two civil engineers with us. Carol Collins represents Kimley Horn, and Kimley Horn was hired by the City of Williamsburg to develop a improvement plan for Long Hill and Ironbound Road, the interchange that's being realigned and re-engineered, as well as the improvements up and down that road. They're designing that under separate contract, and we're fortunate to have them be able to dovetail their work into our work on the site. So Carol will be here to talk about the off-site work and the traffic impact study that his firm prepared. Bob Cosby with AES is our engineer who works with our site design on site They're going to team up here in a few minutes and talk about the civil engineering. And Michael Hall, who you've met before, will talk about the building design and where we stand. I know you do have a copy of this in front of you, so if you wanted to follow along, we want to just retouch some of the milestones that we have. The status of the value engineering workshop, that's coming up in January. That's right after the first of the year, the 11th through the 15th of January. It's a week-long process where your value engineering team is going to review and study our design documents, and they'll be making recommendations to the school district and to the A&E team relative to costs and systems and functions of the design. The special use permit is something that's required because we're actually officially changing the use of the site from an administrative use to a school. So we had to go through the special use permit process, and that's been an ongoing process. But the two major milestones that are coming up tomorrow is the Planning Commission public hearing at 3 o'clock in the afternoon or 3:30. And then the next public meeting is the City Council public hearing, which is on January 14th. Where we'll be addressing the site and the design of the building and the way the site lays out with both of those public agencies. Then we move into the site plan review process, and that goes to Planning Commission in March of 2016. And then your next major milestone is the hiring of your construction management team, which will happen in January and February. That selection process is ongoing right now, and they'll be brought on in January and February. As far as the design documents, they're split into two pieces, actually. We have a separate project that's going to be pre-bid, which will renovate the existing administration building. Once we tear down part of the school, the administration building that's left needs to be renovated, certain portions of it. The site needs to be re-engineered, and then we're going to demolish most of the existing middle school. So that's a separate pre-design package that's going to go out for bids in March, and the construction of that, the demolition and the construction of that will start in May and run through August. And the intent of running it through August is that it clears the site for the building construction to start in September. So our building design process has been ongoing, as you know, and it will complete itself in May. Bid process will take place in June and July. Construction will start in September, conclude 22 months later in June of 2018 for a school opening in September. So none of that schedule has changed since the last time we've met. Really, we just wanted to point out some of these key meetings that are coming up, some of these key public meetings. The next slide, you've seen this before. This is in a little bit more detail. This is the school administration building. First floor is on the top, second floor is on the bottom, and you can see the yellow areas that we've highlighted. Those are the areas of the building that we're going to touch the most. To the right of that red dotted line is where the main middle school building is located, which will be demolished somewhere along that red line. That's still being worked out exactly where that line cuts, but that's pretty close to where it's going to be cut. The yellow area on the upper right is there's an existing conference room, and that's going to be converted to mechanical and electrical spaces to house all the equipment that's going to need to be relocated into this building from the building that's going to be demolished. We're cutting off all the services, so that room will be converted into a mechanical room. Down on the far left, we've relocated the receptionist who currently sits out by the main lobby. We've relocated that reception area down to the left-hand side of the building and carved out a conference room since we lost the conference room at the upper right. And the main entrance to this building is going to be coming in from the left-hand side now. That parking lot that's out there right now will be expanded. That's one of the first things that's going to have to happen is that parking lot will be expanded. The entrance will be improved. There's going to be ADA access brought in that side of the building with a ramp. And that'll all happen this summer. There will be a shutdown of some mechanical, electrical services we mentioned last time. That's going to happen somewhere in the middle of July as we tie in the new systems for mechanical systems, plumbing, fire suppression, water, electricity, and all that technology. Are there any questions on any of that? If not, I'm going to clear the way and bring up the two civil engineers so they could talk about the site.
Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen of the board, Dr. Constantino, I'm Carol Collins with Kinley Horn Associates, involved with preparing the traffic study, and as you heard, or what you may know, is part of the special use permit application process involves preparing a traffic study that essentially is an assessment of the proposed use, and it looks at the traffic generation characteristics of the proposed use, taking into account densities, in this case, number of students. It also looks at trip generation, assigning that traffic to the adjacent roadway network and intersections in an assessment of traffic operations as it relates to level of service, and or comes up with and identifies recommendations where necessary to maintain adequate level of service on the roadway and or additional improvements that are consistent with the site plan or the vision for the development. So with that, we took into account the proposed trip generation, and we actually looked at two different scenarios. We looked at phase one, which is the 600 students that are proposed under that condition, and the school opening in 2018, as well as phase two, which looked at the 900 student scenario and projected out to 2023 on that one. And we look at AM and PM traffic operations. AM and PM traffic operations as they relate to the school, when it's the peak operational conditions of the school, when your primary arrival for students get dropped off or buses and primary dismissal during the afternoon. And from that exercise, particularly for 2018, understanding with the school opening at that time and, oh, by the way, a roadway and intersection improvement project planned and getting ready to get under design and constructed concurrently, took that into account as part of the operation. So within that, we were able to look at, it actually works out really nice from a timing standpoint to have roadway improvement projects going underway, taking into account as far as the site layout is concerned, where users and their driveways could be located and then accounted for as part of the roadway design. From the timing standpoint, works out really well as we look at the bus loop access driveway along Long Hill, the front door, if you will, driveway with parents coming in off Long Hill, and then an access driveway for egress in for traffic coming out of the site, and then maintaining, particularly under phase one, where the administrative staff will continue to use their driveway off of Long Hill Road as well. So we took into account those proposed improvements, as well as made some enhancements to the original concept that were out there, focusing on access management. With access management, not everybody and all movements are accommodated at the intersection, but with understanding the proposed improvements with the roadway, is a signalized intersection is part of the goal and objective with the intersection project. So there's a realignment of Long Hill and its intersection with Ironbound Road. And with that will come a signalized intersection, two driveways along Long Hill, the access driveway that comes on Ironbound Road serving egress primarily during dismissal, arrival and dismissal times will be exit only. And that's part of the collaborative effort working with the city and schools and the site engineer from a safety standpoint and its proximity to that new intersection, that would be egress only during those peak periods to avoid, you know, from a safety standpoint, from an operation standpoint, how that would be set up. And then also taking into account bike and ped accommodations with sidewalk along the periphery of the school, and then a multi-use path, and Bob will talk a little bit more about that. But that's primarily the focus was access management, maintaining adequate traffic operations, and then the safety component. And I will touch on one thing, and you may have seen the slide up there. Level of service D was essentially what we were able to maintain. And I know there's a lot of educators in the room, but D is okay when it comes to traffic operations. So that is being able to maintain good traffic operations, good flow, relatively minimal delay at the end of the day for a peak period or two peak periods during traffic operations.
All right, a little bit about the site plan. As Carol had already discussed on the improvements on the roadway for Long Hill and Ironbound, when we look internal to the site, we look at the three uses that we have on the on the project site. First and foremost, it is James Blair Middle School, so we needed to make sure we had adequate parking for the staff, for the teachers, and the administrators that are going to be on site. So we looked in front of the school for that. One of the issues we have within Wayne and James City County is parent-student drop-off. Usually we have about 50 to 60 cars at a middle school of this size bringing in the students for drop-off as opposed to using the buses. So with that, we needed enough stacking space on site to prevent that from backing up into Long Hill Road and out into the intersection and Ironbound. So we have a path that comes through the site, through the parking lot, and we have that long drop-off directly in front of the school, sidewalk along a good portion of it, so we can get about 12 cars stacked in there, dropping off and picking up at one time and then moving on. When they exit out of there, they can exit out the right out onto Ironbound Road, or they can continue through the parking lot and enter onto Long Hill, entering to the intersection, the lighted intersection at Ironbound, to head to Richmond Road, or they can turn left towards the other site, towards Points West. So with that, one of the elements we had in there, we did not want to have any cars that were sitting stacked, waiting to drop off, impacting the cars exiting. So that was an important element of the path as we flow through here. So that took care of most of the issues for the school itself. The bus drop-off is another important issue to work through. We looked to the school design at Hornsby Middle out there. Initially, we started with the same design that they had. During construction of that school, we went back and looked at the notes and said, hey, we could do it a little bit differently, and they were able to shorten up and use less asphalt, which is a positive thing for everybody. So we shortened up the site of the school drop of the bus drop-off loop to function more how Hornsby is actually operating out there, which was a change they had made during construction on that school, saving us a bunch of asphalt, providing more space for the play fields for the school, which was an important aspect as well. The second use in the site is a central office for the admin building. That'll continue to be utilized. It comes in off the towards Dillard Complex with the entrance there. They have an existing parking lot that's out there that's a little bit too small for their final use. So we've talked to the City of Waynesburg about how can we expand that parking lot in a couple directions to get it up to about 100 parking spaces in there. Their entrance remains the same entrance as out there today, with an upgrade to it to make it a standard commercial entrance, which will help some of the issues that they have getting in and out of that parking lot currently that we've already heard about from several members that work there currently. And then the third use on the site is Cooley Field. Cooley Field will continue to operate as is. The fence area gets a little tighter in when we're looking at Long Hill Road, but that's from the improvements of Long Hill Road from the intersection, from the roadway improvements there. We have the parking in the bus loop for Cooley Field. We have parking over at Kiwanis Park. We have the parking in the admin as well as on the site in the main parking that can utilize that area as needed. For back to school functions, that becomes a big issue with parking as well. We have access to Kiwanis Park next door to provide access for that, as in addition to the parking that is on site. As we move into phase two of the school, the admin building goes away. Additional parts of the building are added. It goes up to 900 students. We need a little extra parking for staff, so we added a parking lot that connects the admin central office parking as well as the main lot across the frontage, realigned the entrance on Ironbound Road to align with Middle Street, so we don't have an offset intersection there because that was an issue for the city. And that addresses all of the issues that we needed with phase two for on-site to provide a little more parking for that auditorium that's added in, as well as for the extra students that would need it in, as well as the extra staff that's required with those elements. Jumping back, one of the other items we had in the site, there is a asphalt multi-use trail that runs through the site. That is the loop from the rec center down the street that will be coming down Long Hill, coming through the site to avoid pedestrians and bicycles at the intersection, and then continuing out Ironbound back to Long Hill Connector and then up into the site again. So that completes that loop, which is a long-term project on the City of Waynesburg's capital improvement project, and they're handling the aspects of coming down Long Hill and coming down Ironbound to get to there. But this was an element that was very important to the city to include a path through here that got those folks off of the road in front of the school and off of all of our entrances and enable them to come through the site between the areas. So that was an element that is added into the site as well. And then we'll answer any questions y'all have afterwards.
Good evening. Michael Hall with Fanning Howie. First, I'd like you to know that we had a day-long meeting with all the departments in the district, the curriculum people and their representatives, probably more like a month ago now. Listened to each group, their representatives, critique the design at that point, went back, made the changes, then copied those sections of the plan and sent it back out to those groups so that they could sign off on it. Got their feedback. One point, we might have made a second round of changes on one thing. But everybody that has ownership in the educational aspects of the building has had feedback into the design process and has worked with us to offer comment and suggestions. And so that's been a very positive experience with them. What you're seeing up here is what we call our master floor plans. We are heading towards the end of our design development phase, which means the next phase is we will develop construction documents for bidding. And so we take the master floor plan and break it up into units so that we can use larger plans to show more information. This shows the phase one master plan. You can see the 300 unit, unit E off to the right, 300 students, and the auditorium down to the bottom, unit F. And then that unit, as it's exploded into a larger drawing, this is the administrative area. You can see where the office is, where people come in to the front up at the top of the sheet. A couple classrooms in there. The art lab is in the lower left corner. And you'll see this on all these drawings. You're starting to see dimensions. You're seeing window openings. You're seeing wall types, door numbers, wall construction notes that we put on there. So we are, you know, moving right along here like the Muppets with making this thing move quickly and keep developing it. Thank you very much. Unit B is the academic pod, and this is repeated three times on three floors. So you can see as you come into that pod from the bottom in the center, right as you come past it, is a multi-use lab. And then the first room on the left and the first room on the right past the toilets is the larger science classroom. Then we have three generic classrooms, each with the glazed walls that open out onto the large space in the middle, which is the collaboration space. And then this is carried up through the building on three floors. There are 200 students in this pod on each floor. This is Unit C, which has the locker rooms, the gym, the auditoria, cafetorium, the kitchen, and the drama classroom, which we had to add after meeting with the staff. And then you'll see the stage between the cafeteria and the gymnasium, which opens so that you can serve that stage either to the gym or to the cafeteria space. Met with the phys ed people, went through locker counts, what kind of lockers, what size of lockers, how many lockers. So that's all been figured out and is being developed. Then the last unit here, D, shows the band, vocals, and orchestra classrooms in the lower left. And then up to the right again, is you'll see the public restrooms and the drama classroom. This is the second floor over the office area, which is where the media center is. A couple more classrooms up there. And then the second floor unit goes up to the top of the drawing. This is that second floor replication of that classroom wing again. And now we're up to the level three plan, which shows the third floor classrooms that feed into the third floor academic section. And there's a large storage area up there and the stairs that come up. So I know this is all kind of dead and boring, but we are moving into the design development phase. And this is where we really start putting things down so that we can get pricing and sizes and quantities and bid the job. And that's that level three again for the academic section. Okay, this is what we call the gathering stair. It comes down into the main entrance points. The stairs that are going up out of the picture kind of are going up to the third floor. The white floor kind of in the middle is the second floor, and you'll see the ghost lady coming down the stairs to the first floor. So students off to the right, place to congregate, a place to hang out, a place to study. And the other thing we've added, and this actually came out of the staff meetings, is in the lower, kind of lower left-hand corner on the first floor, you'll see something that looks like a glassed-in display case. That will be the school history wall. And we will bring some artifacts in from the older building and start to really portray the history of James Blair School so that it becomes a piece of the community historically forever. And we think it's right in the main entrance, right across the administrative area. We also intend to come across the hall and probably have a large flat panel that's running some video. And we're talking about taking five or six auditorium chairs out of the old auditorium, having them refinished and put in that main entrance as a place to sit where people can maybe watch the historical video. So, you know, we're also, we're concerned about teachers and students, but we're concerned about the community as well. So we'll have some, it's another shot of that gathering stair that comes down towards the cafeteria. So pretty much we're moving right along and developing everything based on our staff meetings and preparing for the value engineering exercise in January. This, you haven't seen this before, this is the first pass at the exterior elevation. You were standing up in the intersection at Long Hill and Ironbound. This is kind of what you would see to the left. Lower level is the administrative area, upper level is the media center. Main entrance is kind of in the center there with the taller element. And then the three-story academic section is off to the right. We're kind of going around the building on the base with one color brick maybe, another color brick as we come up above it. And then the third story would have a lighter color, white or drive it or something. And a lot of this will be determined in the value engineering, what materials cost and what's the best value for us to sheathe this building. So we're rocking and rolling on this, and everybody seems to be happy. The staff meetings were really good, and a lot of input back from them, and you know, those are always valuable, and that's not the last time we'll talk to them, so we'll get a little further down the road. Now, there are other documents that support all this, and I'm not going to show you because we'd be here all night, but there's all those same floor plans that have mechanical equipment, another set that has electrical equipment, another set that has plumbing piping, another set that has structural beams and columns and foundations, and then there's all the civil drawings that our engineers will be doing. There's also a set of furniture drawings that show where all the loose furniture goes. So there's a whole stack of drawings already done that we are developing for the value engineering piece. So that's our first pass at this, and it'll obviously be tweaked as we move forward, but it's not ultra-modern design, and it's not 1699 Williamsburg either. It's kind of a nice, I think, sensitive approach to what we think this building needs to be as a STEM school. So, and now we're down to Q&A.
Ms. Emanuel.
Well, I asked you before, and I attended a session during the Virginia School Boards Association about using solar panels and things like that, and they said, we really need to put that in because we're building this for 50 years from now. And we would save enough money that we should really be concentrating on that. And I know that some people poo-pooed that, but I really believe that. And the governor said he's just cut a ribbon on the largest solar plant in the United States. So I would think that is something we ought to be looking at.
We will be looking at it in the value engineering and putting pricing on it. The other thing, school we visited in Arizona, they've got a huge solar array, and a lot of that was done by the superintendent working with a local power company to get some grants. So this may not be your dollars because sometimes those get funded by the electrical companies to put power back into the grid so they don't have to expand their side of the outlet. The electrical meter. So that's not off the table at all. It's totally there.
I'm glad to hear that.
Yes.
Also, water-saving toilets, I would suggest.
Absolutely. I mean, after all, if it's a STEM education, science, technology, engineering, math, it should have STEM features in it. It should connect kids to the environment. And we'll have a display in the main entrance that shows what kind of energy the building's using, how much is coming from solar, how much is coming from, if we have wind turbines, which we've done those. So kids can learn as they're coming in that this building
like
is using energy and also maybe producing energy.
Ms. Larson.
Thank you. I have one question that was brought up about the path that was going to go back, the city, just safety. That's a lot of pedestrians walking behind our school. Just is that something that had been discussed?
Safety issues have been brought up with it. There are trailheads on other schools within the county. The issues also come back to the safety of the pedestrians as well,
right,
as to be better off coming through the site between the areas and not having to cross four entrances coming to that intersection, as well as coordinating with the intersection itself as they're walking or biking through the area.
Okay. And that's a well-used path, and 99.9 or, you know, or probably up until this point, 100% of the people that are walking on that path have no ill will meant towards a school, but it is a concern because that does increase the traffic in the back of the school, so the walking traffic. So just something that we should be aware of as we move forward. So then I had a question regarding the bathrooms. I see where the it looks as though the male bathrooms have urinals versus stalls.
They have both.
Okay. It's hard to tell. I'm sorry. I tried shining my flashlight on there.
If you're looking at a small-scale drawing, it's probably very hard to tell.
But I...
We have to work off the plumbing code. So there are so many urinals required based on the number of boys, so many stalls that are required based on the number of boys, so many sinks, and then you do the same thing again for the female restrooms.
So is it not to code to just stall all toilets in a boys' men's bathroom? I just, with what's going on in our country and the different things that school divisions are facing as far as litigation, et cetera, I just wondered if we should have some thinking there as to just making basically the bathrooms that could be, you know, they could be a female, they could be a male bathroom, wouldn't. So is that something that could just be thought about and talked about?
Absolutely.
So we could get...
I mean, right now, I think we're providing what we call family restrooms adjacent to these large restrooms.
I saw that.
That serve different populations.
Right.
There's a lot of different litigation going on around the country,
right,
about it. I'd probably like to talk with Dr. Constantino about it and maybe talk to your attorney about it.
Right. Just a question that I had. And then I think right now that's all my questions. Thank you so much for the update.
Thank you. Mrs. Cook?
I'm curious about the process that you used to solicit feedback from the WJCC staff. And particularly, I'm curious if anything in particular came out of those conversations that struck you or changed the way you did things. I'm just curious what your impression of that feedback
was. Like this
was.
Drawing here. We went back and forth on whether we needed that corridor between the locker rooms and the gym, because at Hornsby, there's not a corridor. You go through the gym to get into those locker rooms. And initially, the staff thought that would probably be okay, but the more we talked about it, it kind of made more sense to have the corridor there and keep them so they have kind of separate access and a way to get back through the building without going through the gym. So we made that change. This, you don't see it on this drawing. You actually see it at the lower left corner of Unit D. You'll see a dotted thing that says Phase 2 Fitness. That's the fitness lab, which was requested during the design sessions with the staff. It had not been in the program, and so we talked about where should it be? Should it be buried in there with the locker rooms? No. It makes more sense for it to maybe be accessible to the public as well, So we have a location for it. As we go through the value engineering, we'll put a number on it and see if it fits into the budget now as an alternate or if it needs to be in phase two. But we will, you know, those were probably the two biggest things that came up. Plus, the other one was, and I showed you this, the two bigger classrooms, one's on the left, one's on the right, that stick out a little bit, those are science classrooms. They're dedicated science. And originally they were the same size as the other ones. But the more we talked with the science staff, they've got a very robust science program that goes on in the classroom. Even though there's a lab in the middle that can be shared, the more we got into it, it felt like they needed more square footage in the actual classroom to do some of the activities. And one of them was measuring physical impact, kids jumping up and down, and some things that teacher does. So, you know, we listened and then went back and modified to make sure that we were accommodating what we heard. I don't remember hearing anything that was out of line.
Thank you for doing.
Yeah. Can I just add one to that topic? In addition to the curriculum folks and the educators, we also met on a separate day with maintenance staff, mechanical systems, plumbing systems, electrical systems, technology, the bus driving, the transportation folks, food service folks. So not only did we cover everything from an educational standpoint, but also from the physical facility. We met with all those folks as well as far as materials to use in the building, what type of mechanical equipment to use, and all those types of things. So those were separate meetings from the educators.
Mr. Fuentes.
Yes, going back to your site plan.
Make sure you get in the mic there, Joe.
These mics.
Say site plan?
The site plan. I just have just a couple clarifications or questions. Which one was the exit only? Of those.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
I don't know, I was looking at the one you were looking at, so I don't
know. We have a better diagram here.
Oh.
Yeah, this one helps to disguise that path as it comes through. But the exit only is out onto Ironbound Road, right at the exit of the parent drop-off pickup area.
Oh, that's
you can do a right exit out there during pickup and drop-off. You cannot enter in there.
Oh, that's
one of the requirements of the city. They would prefer everybody come through the intersection and come through the main entrance to the parking lot. During off hours, during non-pickup and drop-off, you can come as a right in off of Ironbound. So you don't have to turn down Long Hill to then come back into the lot.
So the buses always have?
The buses will always come off of Long Hill.
Oh, they're in the, okay, they're
bus
in the yellow.
I'm sorry,
I got the loops mixed up. Okay, yeah. The buses are in the back, okay. And actually, I'm glad I asked that because I actually thought it was the other one that was the exit only one. So yeah, that clarified. The other question I had was regarding Cooley Field. Are we maintaining Cooley Field? I mean, we're going to keep Cooley Field as a football field?
Yeah, Cooley Field remains as it currently is today. The bleachers that are there will be there. The field is still there. The locker rooms that are over on the one side are still there.
The bleachers, everything, so we can still use that?
The visiting locker room is out in the middle of the current bus loop, so that has to be moved and relocated somewhere on the site. And the fence that's out by Long Hill Road, as Long Hill expands, that fence gets moved. But
okay, and then with that, they're planning on. I really didn't realize it, how wide they were going to make that, but they're putting in turn lanes. I see. So going back to what Ms. Larson brought up, of course, we this pathway. So the school property, the school's going to maintain all this property, right? I mean, it's going to stay with the schools, not part of parks, recreation, any of that. It stays the fields, right? Correct?
Right.
Okay. Well, I share some of Ms. Larson's concern about having that go through. That's why I was wondering if our property line was going to end at that line there or whether it was going to extend. And then the other question I had was, you brought up the fitness, and maybe I missed it. Maybe you described it during your tech. What was the fitness room going to be used for?
Workout room, cardio machines, and those type of things.
This is all the students. This is
It could be used as a community fitness center. That's why we put it on that corner there, so you could
So they can get
into that at night? Pardon me?
I was joking. So you can get to the path. I was just kidding.
We change clothes and go out and run the path.
The fitness labs. We have fitness rooms at the other middle schools.
Right. I was just asking what it was. I didn't know when you said about the staff. I didn't know whether that was something for this just going to be staff or whether that was
No. This was a student-centered fitness.
Okay.
Development. Yeah.
Okay. That was all I had. Thank you.
Any other board member questions? Couple of questions. Dropping off of students. I guess my question is, where do you get your metrics for how many students are going to be dropped off at this school at 50?
You underestimated.
60? We were looking back at the other middle schools in the area as to how many parents pick up and drop off at those. So that number was provided by school.
All right. You might just want to go to Berkeley or Hornsby and just count them one morning. I think you might come more than 50. Or you can ask Mr. Stone to count it tomorrow morning. He'll be happy to do that for you.
Because we're at Toano, and I'm very familiar with the process that was out there when they were there.
I'm sure most of
us. I made a very long path for that reason.
Well, that is true. I mean, that's a good cue, and they don't cross, so that should help, as opposed to where we have at some of our schools. As I'm looking at this lot here and the traffic road, there's no traffic lights required. Based upon what were our traffic study.
Well, the traffic signal will get installed at the Long Hill Ironbound Road intersection as a part of the roadway improvement projects.
Right, which is separate to us.
And so that is kind of your key traffic control measure that gets introduced in and around the school site. Schools by themselves just don't generate enough traffic over the course of the day to warrant a traffic signal. So in all these cases, unsignalized intersections, they all operate adequately. The turn lanes are in place, but from a level of service and or just general operations, and that's also why we got into some of the partial access, those access management strategies to restrict some movements, or why other locations aren't identified for signalization.
Similar to the problem we have at Jolly Pond in Centerville, where we don't have a light there because we have morning traffic and afternoon traffic, but we don't have traffic.
Very familiar with that one. I think we've done 3 signal warrant analyses up at that intersection. It's getting closer on the cusp as far as warranting a signal, but none of these intersections in a school just by itself isn't going to generate enough traffic to warrant a traffic signal.
Gotcha. Back to the path, that path is used 6 a.m. to 10 p.m. Is there going to be lighting on that path? I mean, right now the lighting is from the road that comes around, but as we go back into our property here, is there lighting envisioned to?
City has not requested any lighting on it at this time.
Okay. Might be something else you want to think about. Because that path is used during the dark hours, and I'm not sure how much ambient light's going to be back there from our facility, from the parking lot. But something to think about and really seriously consider. You mentioned the parking for Kiwanis to support Cooley. Having been to many events at Cooley and never being allowed to park at Kiwanis, you might want to just ask the city there if that's an option, because I've always parked here and had to walk half a mile and said, look at all that parking I could go do right there. So
city was focused on making sure we had a pathway to connect Kiwanis and the parking lot for use of after school events, things at Cooley and other things. So that was something they actually specifically asked for. So
I would like to see that this spring for soccer games, but the gathering stair. Can you explain? Go back to the plan views and show where that stair is, so I make sure I have the vision.
Up on the third floor, it's that trapezoidal space. It's kind of in the center there.
Okay. Got you.
And you come down from the third floor, go downstairs, turn, be turning right, going down again, and then you're down to the second floor where it empties, and then there's an atrium type hole, I guess, in the floor there that looks down over the main entrance. You come off of that second floor landing over to the left, and that's where there's a gathering stair and there's a regular stair. You see those to the left there?
Yep.
Okay. And so that brings you, if you go down those, then you're down to the first floor. Right there, as you come off of those, you're looking right into the cafeteria.
The one concern that I'm sure we have thought about this as you propose that, is that that seems to be a social gathering location. I'm worried about ADA issues.
Well, we have the elevator in there. The elevator's right in that area.
Yeah.
But in terms of a ramp, we don't have the space for a ramp.
I understand that. And I saw on the second floor, I think you look like you have a little alcove there. But it's just for inclusiveness at the middle school, it's going to be kind of tough for that to be done with.
But kids, any child can get over to that stair on the first floor if they want to hang out in that area. You know, it's not like walled off or railing off. We're trying to be as inclusive with it as we can. And because the other thing that's going on, it's a little hard to see on this drawing. Where that stair is ending up is right where all the kids are coming in from the buses.
Okay.
So they're coming in from the buses. They'll have the cafeteria space right there off to their right, gathering stair off to their left, and on down the hallway going out that direction is the administrative area. So it's all kind of right there in the center of that traffic flow. And I think, you know, we've had success with these, particularly in middle schools.
Okay.
Kids just like place to hang that is informal and
right.
promotes some social
right.
interaction.
Right. Okay. Good start. I guess next month we get the 35%.
Yep.
And we'll see that. Mrs. Cook?
Mr. Chair, thank you. I had one more question about that path. I recognize that the city wants it to go through the property so that you're not having to negotiate several entrances. But if children want to walk or bike to school, is there connectivity from the city sidewalks into an entrance of the school? Because that's currently a problem at Berkeley, for instance, that there's no, you can walk to the school, but then once you get there, good luck.
There will still be a sidewalk that parallels Long Hill Road and Ironbound in front of the school site,
uh-huh.
inside the right-of-way, so that you can come down the 10-foot multi-use path. When you come to the bus loop entrance, you can divert to the right to continue on the 10-foot multi-use, or you can stay on the 5-foot sidewalk to come into the front entrance. For students coming in, there is pathways connecting first from that sidewalk between the bus loop and the small annex parking off to the side there that brings them over into the classroom area wing that they can come in through the bus entrance or through the main entrance. There's also a sidewalk over closer to the main entrance that comes through. And for folks coming down Ironbound Road, there's sidewalks there that connect into our main entrance sidewalk as well. So we are connecting it at least three locations so far. And also one over at the admin sidewalk for there that connects in. So four locations we're connecting to the public sidewalk that's in front of the site.
Mr. Fuentes.
Well, she brought up a good point about the bikes. Since one of the biking and walking, the safe routes to school and all that, where's the bike parking for both staff and the students?
Coordinating where that is going to be still. But it has been thought about where will they park, and we're locating that on the site at this time still.
Okay, just so we, you know, that, because the safe route, that whole thing, right. Thank you.
Any other comments from board members? Mr. Nichols.
Just the Aldi construction, the supermarket across the way. Is that entrance?
Yes, sir.
So how does that play into all of this?
So as part of the intersection improvements, and actually that traffic, the traffic study for the Aldi retail development was started back in April, so it's a little bit ahead of the curve as it related to getting the traffic study underway for the school. So that developer comes down, has a plan, but the site access driveway that'll serve that site coming off of Ironbound Road has been incorporated. In fact, guidance was given off of the concept for the intersection and roadway improvements for Ironbound and Long Hill. That guidance was given to the developer that they needed to match the vision, if you will, for those improvements. And they took that back to the drawing board, made adjustments, and incorporated that leg of the intersection into their plans so that it aligned with what the intent was for improvements at the intersection. In fact, they had a dedication of some right-of-way for that exclusive eastbound right turn lane that'll serve their site in the future. So it has been accounted for.
Any other comments? Thank you. I appreciate it, gentlemen. Look forward to next month.
Thank you.
Brings us to personnel actions, 9.01, action items, 9.01 personnel actions. Can I get a motion for approval of the personnel actions as presented?
Mr. Chairman, I move the personnel actions as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for the personnel action, approval of the personnel actions. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, Ms. Erza?
Mr. Fuentes?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Abstain.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.2, minutes from the 11 November 10th, 15, and November 17th, 15 meetings. Can I have a motion for approval?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for approval of the minutes from the November 10th and November 17th minutes. Is there any discussion? Hearing none, it's been moved and seconded for approval of minutes from 11:10 and 11:17. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Abstain.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel?
Aye.
Mr. Fuentes?
Aye.
Ms. Larson?
Aye.
Mr. Nichols?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. 9.03, approval of the fiscal year 2017-2026 capital improvement plan. Can I get a motion for approval so we can start a discussion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
We're moving that we approve the plan as presented?
Yes. It has been seconded. It has been moved and seconded for approval of the fiscal year.
To discuss it.
For the fiscal year 2017-2016 capital improvement plan. Is there any discussion, Mr. Fuentes?
Okay. What is it that we're moving? There's something that was here, and there was something that was presented in the... Which one are we talking about?
Dr. Constantino?
Okay.
Mr. Chair, members of the board, this evening, superintendent and his staff are recommending changes to the original recommended capital improvement plan. Based on your conversation at the November 17th meeting and also conversation with the general public and specifically with the Lafayette issues that we have heard, we have tried to address those issues. Ms. Berta and Mr. Snipes are here to take you through those proposed changes and answer any questions you might have.
Go.
As Dr. Constantino said, have presented some revisions to the original superintendent's proposed capital improvement plan based on community input and school board comments. Those adjustments that we have made, I will walk you through. First is the Stonehouse bus loop canopy. That is being moved from fiscal year 21 to fiscal year 17 in the plan before you. The Lafayette High School auxiliary gym is being added to fiscal year 17. The Lafayette High School practice field lighting is being added to fiscal year 18. The Lafayette High School walkway to the War Hill Sports Complex is being added to fiscal year 19. In order to accommodate the Lafayette High School auxiliary gym in fiscal year 17, it is being recommended that the Norg HVAC replacement be moved from fiscal year 17 as originally presented to fiscal year 18. Other than that, there are no additional changes to the proposed original presentation. With the acceptance of this modification to the 10-year capital improvement plan, you would need to approve a 10-year plan in the amount of $102,895,182.
So back to Mr. Fuente's point, Ms. Manuel, moved for approval? Was the modified plan? And Mr. Nichols seconded, right?
Can we add it as amended?
It's already.
Has changed? Oh, it already.
It's modified.
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions? Comments? Ms. Cook?
I have a question about the change in the Norge HVAC. I'm not sure what that entails. Does that include all duct work and anything that might impact air quality in that school?
Are you asking me whether the changes to the Norge?
Well, an HVAC replacement. Can you tell me what that entails and what that might impact in the environment of the school?
Well, the HVAC replacement is for life cycle cost and replacement, which means we have not replaced it when it was under warranty. So now it is being replaced in fiscal year
17. We moved it to 18.
We moved it to 18, so it will be beyond its warranty, and that just replaces ductwork, it replaces components. It's a complete replacement of the Norge HVAC system.
I'm curious have there been any studies about, is there anything that would negatively impact the air quality of the environment of that school that moving this down out another year would negatively impact the environment of the air quality inside that school? Have there been any tests? Is it tested annually?
We have not done an indoor air quality test at Norge to test the air quality, if that is your question.
That's not done regularly?
That's not a regular request unless we have a complaint about indoor air quality or we have an issue that has been brought to our attention.
Sure.
Ms. Larson?
Sure. If I have not said so, I very much appreciate this forward-thinking document. It's been extremely helpful. And I think that the speaker that spoke earlier was correct. I think it's very important to have that 10-year outlook. And I know that there will be adjustments that will be made, but I appreciate all the work that went into that. And the question that was also raised about when we're going to look at the other middle schools as we bring the other one on board, but knowing that the James Blair Middle School has a different component as it is a STEM school. But is that something that as you go through to do an equity audit, which I hope we will be able to do system-wide, it's something that I've talked about in the past and I'd like to see us be able to do. Would that, if you did see deficiencies in the other middle schools that you needed to address, would you put those in your capital plan? Given the dollar amount?
Yes.
Okay. And I also had talked last year about the need for an athletic facilities study. But realizing that, you know, there's only so much money to go around, and a study like this, you know, takes some funds. But I hope that we will work our way towards doing an athletic facilities. I know that some of it is addressed in here and that we are, you know, that we're graded on some of our high schools, different things that we did not have. I just think that it's important to know, you know, like tonight someone said all of Jamestown's fields are lit. Well, only the, I believe, softball and baseball are lighted. So some of our fields are lit at our elementary school because we have a partnership with the rec department. I think fields are lit at Hornsby because those are also used by our rec department. We have some partnerships going on there. So I do hope, though, that moving forward we are able to do an equity audit so that we have a better idea. Also our community, so we don't, so things aren't said that may not necessarily be be truthful, and that everybody, there will be an easy spot to go on our website to find out exactly what do all of our high schools have, or all of our middle schools as far as facilities go, and also an athletic fields audit and facilities audit. I think that those will be important. I think that, you know, we are, our athletic fields and some of our other things is like theater, storage, et cetera, but I'll address our athletic fields this evening, have not kept up with our growth and our other facilities for our athletes. It's something that we had to, given the fiscal reality. They just kept getting pushed back. But truthfully, this has been years in the making. I'm not sure that when high schools were built, that they were built with the facilities that they needed. And I think that you do a disservice to everybody there, because your community, your taxpayers go, oh, wait a minute, you know, you just want to build this, when if you just do things from the beginning in the correct way and the best way to serve students, I think it serves best in the long haul. And so I think that we're on the track and to do better. And so I think we'll have less of that moving forward. And so I appreciate all the work that's been done. It's been a pleasure working with both of you, and I appreciate all of the knowledge that you both have brought. Mr. Snipes and Mr. Robertson, I think that he's left, but I always appreciate all of his historical knowledge as well. So thank you.
Mrs. Kordaska.
Well, I guess first of all, I would like to say thank you for the completion of a 10-year plan. I know that was a high priority, and it's one in which we have stepped ahead of the county. There was one required by the 2009 comprehensive plan. It's 2015. It's never been done. It's difficult to know how to budget for what needs to be done if you're not certain as to what the level of health is of your facilities and your buildings. I also want to say thank you to the parents that came out here this evening. I hope that it continues and that it isn't just about fields and other things. I have sat here for 4 years, and very rarely have we heard from parents except for during budget time. And I really think that we need to hear from parents every meeting, from something to another. But I am concerned, and I do understand that there's a legal term for equity, and I appreciate that legal term. But when I came on the board, one of the things I was frustrated about is that we had built this premier school in War Hill that had a lot of technology and that was supposed to be our technology school. But because of the insistence that everybody have exactly the same, it was not used that way. Now we're in the process of changing that. We have Project Lead the way there. So I think it's important that we do not confuse equity with everybody having exactly the same thing. Because it will be that different schools, and it should be, that different schools have different flavors. And so I think that's a really important thing. The other thing is, and I'm sure this doesn't come as a surprise to you, Ms. Berta, we cannot fund ourselves. And so these will be given over to our funding partners, and face it, primarily that's the county that does the whole bill. And you know, they've just instituted a tax increase. I'm certain that they're not going to want to do that again next year. And so I think we have to deal with the reality that this is going to be a push regardless of what happens. I think it's very important to go along with some of the other things that we've done with regard to Manufacturing Day and our emphasis on other things. We have got to have other opportunities for revenue to come into this county other than property taxes. So I'm hopeful that that will be something, that a message that the county does to make it easier to do business here, because it is not easy to do business here. So I just want to say that I certainly would support placing these things on here. The other thing I want to say is that there was a question raised as to why the walkway ended up costing more money. Well, that's a pretty easy answer. I found out myself this year as a classmate of the LEED Historic Triangle, I had proposed that we build benches at bus stops because there aren't any, and it's a big inconvenience. The cost to build benches is astronomical, basically because of regulations, and we ran up against whether or not we would have to submit to the American Disabilities Act, which then doubled the cost again. So even though the construction of the walkway is not significant, the requirement that it be accessible to all students and the fact that we happen to build our schools on wetlands complicates the matter and makes everything significantly expensive. So it's not a simple issue. I think that I understand the level of frustration that parents have brought out here. At times, though, it's difficult to listen to accusations of lack of concern of student safety or of concern of students not having what they need. I think every person on this dais has spent hours and hours and hours advocating for what the best interest of students and staff and teachers would be. And as you heard from our audit, we had to look at unfunded liabilities for the retirement system. We had significant increase in healthcare costs last year, and we anticipate that probably happening again this year. We have chosen to keep as much money as we can into the classroom. We have not acknowledged the fact that teachers are the key as to whether or not kids succeed. I have children that have participated both in the arts and in sports, very valuable and an opportunity for kids to continue on with their education. So I appreciate the flexibility shown in terms of inserting these projects. I don't think there's anything frivolous on this payout plan. I know that many people have approached us about a swimming pool. Great idea, but it's not something that we've generally had as a part of our culture here. So I want to say thank you for the hard work, for the plan. I want to say thank you for listening and for including. And I also just want to say, let's keep in mind really what the end goal is and what the purpose is, not only of the people on this dais here or the people that work in central office or the people that work in the schools, but also of the parents. I think we are in very, very dangerous territory when we begin to compare, when we begin to look at somebody else having something and thinking that's meant against us. And I think even demonizing the funding partners, knowing that they have their own set of issues that they have to deal with. So
thank you. Mr. Nichols.
No,
Mr. Fuentes.
Well, first let me just ask a protocol question. Is this, when we vote on this tonight, is this just so that this is the what's the marching orders to go off of, this is what our first cut is, and then when we go to vote on the budget, we vote on this when it gets modified?
This is your CIP plan to present to the city and county for them to make their adjustments. Of course, they will send adjustments back to you as part of the operating budget along with the capital, and then you will have to...
We'll vote on it again.
Yes.
So we'll finalize the final vote on it. Okay.
Yep.
So that was the first thing. The other thing is I really do appreciate that the administration, that you took the time to go through this and make adjustments that are... you know, that are in the best interest of the community. The question I have on the $3.5 million that we pushed to the following year on the HVAC, and so I'm thinking about the facility study, and I don't know what it says about that, but what does the facility study talk about on when that should be done, or does it talk about it at all?
The facility study does discuss when that should be done or when it could be done. At the time it was done, I think it said 2 to 3 years that we need to replace that study.
Replace that HVAC system. To 3 years from today.
Right.
So that we have some room on that.
Right.
Okay. And that was, but part of the reason we put it where we put it was based because the warranty runs out.
Based on where the warranty runs out and based on our work order history with that system.
Okay. And so you feel somewhat comfortable that moving it 1 year, the maintenance on that, the cost for that, we're safe moving it 1 year?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. I'm hoping the other part of this, I know we're going to vote on the CIP, the facility study that's there. I'm hoping that, you know, it came late in our process here. Right, we just got this early this year, right? Like before we finished the CIP process?
We got the facility study before we finished the CIP process. I don't know if what you would consider late, but I think we received that in September.
I don't mean late. I don't mean like, but time-wise, I didn't think we had enough time to digest it while we were putting the CIP together.
It was included in all the conversations about our CIP.
Okay, so then you incorporated those comments the best you could into this plan, and then going forward, we're going to try to incorporate some of the other goodness that is in that facility study.
Yes, sir.
So that Mr. Jarman brought up this evening, you know, as far as making our 10-year plan and making sure we have a 10-year plan, and, you know, his point about effective scheduling. There was something else he brought up that, and Ms. Larson alluded to it, but the plan for support for the other middle school, based on this being the programmatics of this middle school that we talked about earlier being so different, and it wouldn't be so much in the CIP, but I think that we need to be thinking ahead as far as some of it would be in the CIP, but the programmatic changes going down the road will affect operationally. So I think we need to be thinking of that also. I don't know if that was what he was referring to, but that was what came to my mind, that we have to be looking down the road on the impact if we're gonna do some of that across the, some of that 21st century learning. There's a couple other things. I know there's these items, and Ms. Larson also alluded to a study of the, you know, of the different schools to make sure that everything is up to par. One of the things that I do want to have a discussion with, and I want to bring back up, that we started studying back in 2006, and somehow, and I've talked with you, Mr. Snipes, about this, and Mr. Robertson, about a year ago, about, you know, when we were talking about the Long Hill Road corridor improvements for the safety at Lafayette. And I'm hoping that is a discussion that we can have with our, with the Board of Supervisors about, and bring that back up. There is one individual that is still on the board that was part of those discussions back in 2006. You know, the entrance to Lafayette, egress, you know, it's, and just the pathways. And I think that we need to address that both as with our partners and that and work together with them as in a partnership to improve that. As we heard individuals talking tonight about, you know, we have the track team that used to jog up and down that road and in the road before Long Hill, when it was two lanes, you know, when I got here, they were literally jogging in the middle of the road. Then when they widened it, that ended. But I'm hoping that we have the discussion with them, and I'm hoping that the administration comes up with some thoughts on things that when we meet with them, there's some ideas on, you know, some of the things we talked about, multi-purpose paths, and particularly the egress right there, and the traffic problems that are right there in front of the school, that we need to address that also. And I know it doesn't specifically go on here on the CIP, it may, because we were responsible. I remember when we built the schools up there, we were responsible for that, for the Centerville. I don't know how we got stuck with that, but we got stuck with the Centerville Centerville Jolly Pond Road improvements. Am I correct on that? Yeah, we got stuck with that. So there's a part of that has to do with us. And you know, I just saw today, I was reading the WY Daily, that, you know, they're getting ready to put a roundabout, or they're talking about a roundabout down at News Road and Centerville. And that was one of the suggestions we had back then for that area also as a traffic calmer, and it was rejected. So that's another area, but right now I'm focusing on Long Hill Road, and I'd like to have that conversation finally, because that has been a big concern for all the students that attend there. But once again, I want to thank you for what you did here on this, and that's all I had.
Mrs. Cook?
I'd like to echo everyone's thanks about this process. Doing it earlier, I think, has meant more meaningful conversation
on this dais, but also providing parental input at a good level, and then the report that informed it. So I just think really great staff work. Thank you very much. I support the addition of the auxiliary gym. I think the Faithful and Gould study justifies that in the educational sustainability score for Lafayette. I think it indicates that. But I'd also like to echo Mrs. Larson and Mr. Fuentes' request for additional study for new facilities, whether they be athletic or otherwise, so that we develop a process to include those in this 10-year plan, so that we're, I don't know what methodology you would use for that, but if it's informed by information, all the better. So I'd like to echo that request as well. So I'm ready to support the CIP as moved today.
Thank you. Mr. Nichols?
Yeah, I want to join the chorus, and I sing tenor, but very badly. Thanking you and the administration for listening to the concerns and adjusting the CIP accordingly. I also think it's really beneficial that the CIP is separated from the budget because it makes it stand out more. And I think it's really important for school administrators and parents of the schools to keep an eye on what's going on in terms of the budget. I mean, there have been many times that we've had hardly anybody here to address the issues of the budget. And so I think it's important that everybody who has a stake in their education of their children be aware of what's going on, not only in terms of what's in the school, but also in the larger scope of things in terms of our budget and our capital improvement plan. And I also agree with Mrs. Codesco about the importance of the word equity and how it's applied. Individual schools have personalities of their own, and they're designed sometimes for particular unique needs, like the new middle school will be designed as a STEM school. So there'll be requirements there at that school that will not necessarily be available in other schools. So, and I think it's important that the school board keep on touch of that and certainly be informed about what's going on in the wider scope of things. So thank you.
Dr. Constantino?
Just one point of order. Mr. Fuentes, I'm not so sure that using the word we're going to be safe in describing delaying Norwich a year is an appropriate term, at least in my opinion. I think we have a system that is already out of warranty, a system that has been repaired, and to the best of our knowledge, we believe will function as it is functioning now for another year. But I'm not going to go as far as Mr. Snipes. He has the technical knowledge. I'm just going to say for the record that safe might be a slight overstatement. I think that we are confident that this system will act in the manner that it's acting now, understanding that tomorrow that could all change.
Thank you for the clarification. I didn't mean to imply there was no risk at all.
Yeah,
that's really my point. There is a risk.
Yeah, right. That's I think that's the word that we're looking at is added
risk. Risk is minimal.
Yeah.
Or risk is low. Well,
acceptable, I think.
Or acceptable, that's the right word.
Yeah, we'll see how that yeah. goes going forward, right?
But there is risk.
Do we know where we're siting the auxiliary gym at Lafayette?
Yes, we have a site plan.
Okay, so we have designs and drawings for where that gym's going to go and what it's going to look like. Okay. I have to echo some of the comments that have been put forward this evening. Not morning yet, but we're close. This evening about the capital plan and moving it away from the operational budget. I think, in previous years when we've had the operational budget and the capital plan together, the capital plan kind of doesn't get the same level of scrutiny that the operational budget does. And I think that moving those two away and apart gives us that visibility. So I think that's a good thing that we've done. When we look at the bottom lines for our capital budget, where do we get those numbers from? Do we work with the county on that and the city?
This budget is based on the needs determined by administration and ultimately by you. So then we present it to the county and city, and they decide how much of this they can fund.
Okay, so as the legislature says, we put together a needs-based budget. So these are what we believe our needs are, and then the city and the county fund as their budgets and their needs dictate. But we don't have any dialogue with them beforehand about what the net number could be. I mean, could that number be, right now the number we have is 4.8, could it be 14.8? I mean, do we have some discussion with the county and the city about the numbers that they might find acceptable?
When we first began this process, we tried to work within their five-year plan that was adopted last year. That now has changed. So we have to present it forward to them and see if they have the funding available to support the needs that we determine are necessary.
Okay, so they're in their five-year capital plan, they have a number in there for the schools?
They do.
And that number has changed?
That number has changed as of this revised copy, yes.
To this number?
Yes.
Okay, so they where we used to have, I think it was 5 point something in the previous capital budget that we had last month, they have changed it since then and gone to 4.8.
Once we present this to them, it goes through their process and it goes to the Planning Commission, and then they will determine the funding that they have available to support the plan. As of the plan last year that they approved, they only adopt funding for 1 year, but they outline a five-year plan projecting what they think they will need for the funding of the projects.
And so those are the numbers we work to, is those five-year numbers.
Correct.
Okay. Because in previous budgets not too long ago, in 2014, if we take out the new facilities, which is the central office and the fourth middle school, we asked for 4.2. They funded 2.0. In 15, we asked for 7.9. They gave us 3.3. And in 16, we asked for 4.2, and they gave us 3.4. So because we asked for it doesn't mean it comes.
Correct.
So... But we also have to be cognizant of the fact that the county has other needs as well. Dr. Constantino, were you?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, I will say to you that in developing the previous CIP, we did look at the projection that the county gave us for 5 years, understanding that we only fund 1 year at a time. My original thinking in direction with the staff and working with the staff and the committees was to do our best to stay within those numbers, hoping that those numbers would end up being real. We don't know that they will or they won't 5 years out. However, we are in a situation of a budget of need. There has been a significant discussion on this board and from the community about needs, and in my investigation going back prior to my arrival here and understanding the situation, it became pretty clear to me that there is more of a need than there is money. So we are, there's a figure in the county budget. We are now exceeding that figure. But I'm confident, I'm glad somebody, I don't remember exactly who said, I don't think there's no fluff in here. There are still other needs that we could add. But we're doing our best to shepherd our way through several years of a recession where lots of things didn't happen. And we talked about a couple of years ago, I can remember in a joint meeting, somebody saying, we're going to have a problem when all of this crashes together. It's crashing together. We're there. So there are going to be some tough decisions that are made at our level, tough decisions that are made at the funding partners level as well.
Right, and then the other piece of paper in front of us, or several pieces, but about the actual CIP expenditures by high school, where since 2007, Lafayette's at 7.5, Jamestown's at 2.1, War Hill's at 96,000, which all makes sense because Lafayette's our oldest school, and so you would put the most money there. So a lot of what you also see here as well is that we have, through the recession and through these times, we focus our money in the classroom and not on the athletic fields. And to our detriment, we've asked, I think last 1 year we asked for the Jamestown locker rooms and that got pushed. You know, Jamestown right now has an issue with the tennis courts and the track, so there's issues over there. So we have issues in all of our schools. So, but with that said, I am comfortable with the CIP that's presented tonight. Mr. Nichols?
I think he had his hand up.
I thought you...
Well, I did, but he was...
Go ahead.
I am going to speak. Go ahead.
Go.
Go ahead, Joe.
Oh, no, I was just going to ask, maybe I'm misunderstanding, but for FY17, it looks like the CIP is going down, correct?
Correct, it is.
Okay, so I get it. So overall, the 10-year plan, it went up because of what we just added. But for next year, it actually is going down, right, based on this adjustment?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. I just want to make sure I understood because I...
5 years. I was speaking in terms of the five-year chunk that is in the county document. So you're correct.
But, well, in both
I wasn't clear. I think in terms of five-year chunks, and I was
No, I get it. I just want to make sure I understood, though, that next year... We're saying the same thing. I'm sorry.
Mr. Nichols?
I was trying to understand the process. How does the... You may not have the answer to this because you're not the county. But they come up with a plan for how they're going to fund our capital improvement plan for a particular year based on what we've submitted to them previously?
What happens is our plan goes before the Planning Commission, and then the Planning Commission makes recommendations to City Council and the Board of Supervisors for both sides. And then they find out what funding stream they have to be able to fund projects and tell us which pieces they are going to fund.
Mr. Chair, go ahead.
So do they look at our 10-year plan and see what it is?
Yes, last year they actually shifted some projects earlier based on funding that they had available. So they make shifts in what you send to them and then send it back to us.
I think the other thing that I forgot to mention, too, is that when family members advocate before the school board for a particular project, the next step is at the City Council and the Board of Supervisors, too. I mean, the buck doesn't stop here. The buck stops at the Board of Supervisors and the City Council. They are people who are funding us.
Following up on what he said, that was another question I wanted to ask, so it dovetailed in. So when it goes to the Planning Commission, they look at it and they come back and they, you know, like the amount that we have, and they say, do they recommend moving the Chiclets on there?
I'm not quite sure how their process works for what they recommend.
Or do they come back and just say, you want this amount of money, but no, we're only going to give you this amount. So do we move the Chiclets on there?
When the county and city approve the CIP, they tell you specifically which projects in the CIP they are willing to fund.
Okay.
So they don't give you a pot of money and you decide where it's placed.
I didn't know whether it was like a back and forth of, no, this is it, you know, and we did a little back and forth.
It's quite a different process from the operating budget where we can control what we fund through the operating budget with the money we receive.
Okay. Thank you for clarifying that.
Any other board member comments?
I will just comment that we did not create the growth that, you know, I mean, we are fortunate in that we have an excellent product, and so people want to come here and put their children in our schools, and I'm appreciative of all the work that goes into making that happen. But we didn't approve housing and that type of thing. So we do need support in order to fund the things that our students need. And so, and I don't say that, you know, I'm just trying to say that, you know, there's roles, but there's also reasons. So, you know, we have to work towards a solution. So, thank you.
Sure, any other comments? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the modifications to the proposed CIP, CIP summary 12-15-15. Ms. Sears.
Ms. Emanuel.
Aye.
Mr. Fuentes.
Aye.
Ms. Larson.
Aye.
Mr. Nichols.
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Brings us to 9.04, policy JM, restraint and seclusion, second reading. Can I have a motion, please?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item number 9.04, policy JM, restraint and seclusion, second reading.
Is there a second? So we can start a discussion. Mr. Nichols has seconded. Is there any discussion on policy JM, restraint and seclusion? Ms. Bourgeois, I see you're in front of us. Dr. Constantino?
Yeah, Mr. Chair, members of the board, as you recall, we did delay bringing this policy back to you to make some changes based on conversations. We've submitted those changes to you, and certainly Mrs. Bourgeois is here to answer any questions you might have.
Any board members have any questions? Ms. Larson?
Thank you. There have been some, we have received a considerable email and also phone calls regarding this policy, and the two, in each of the conversations that I've had with concerned parents and citizens, the two pieces that were brought out earlier this evening. So if you could speak to that. And I also want to tell you a little bit about what I assured people, because there's sometimes a hesitancy to come forward to speak to us and to send emails. And I always try to forward emails to you that I receive so that you know. And I assured people that we have worked very hard, and that, you know, we want to hear from everyone, and we want to continue. I heard continuously from the members of the SEAC committee that did reach out to me that this board and this administration was committed to establishing a good working relationship with that committee, and we valued their input. And so I know that you feel the same way, but I just want to have that, state that publicly. And so if you could speak to the two things, because I think there is some concern on my part that, you know, that we do wait until we have the expected guidelines that are going to come down to us, and to do a policy at that point. So, to you.
And that is certainly one consideration for the board to determine. The whole process was started based on a recommendation from our attorneys, based on the fact that we currently have no policy in place. So there are no safeguards or protections. There are no requirements for appropriate use and under what circumstances it might be used. And that was the concern. Right now, there's nothing there. So the recommendation came from our attorneys to put something in place, recognizing the fact that there would most likely be revisions. And when we brought this for you for the first reading, I think we acknowledged that we knew that was going to happen in the future. So that is certainly one consideration. The two concerns that I've heard, one of them has to do with the terminology quella disturbance. Part of what guides us is the fact that this policy is for all students. And so we have to try to look at how to capture as globally yet clearly as possible certain circumstances without being able to possibly identify what those specific incidents may look like. So for instance, for me, for quell disturbance, you know, I go back to my principal days when you've got 300 middle school students in a cafeteria and a fight starts, and that can easily escalate to something that can really be very dangerous for the safety of the students involved as well as other students. So for me, that's where the quella disturbance description would come in. It was a situation like that. The best thing I can do is give you an example of how I would see it applying. I think the other piece you're talking about is mechanical restraints. And again, we acknowledge at the first reading that it's not a current practice. The board can determine whether or not it's appropriate to put it in the policy. We don't have any guidelines restricting its use right now, and so that's why it was included to begin with.
So then, Mrs. Cardasco.
Well, if you remember when we had our policy review, what we talked a lot about professional development, and we talked about the fact that sometimes, most times, special educators are provided with that kind of guidance, but sometimes regular classroom teachers are not. And I had inquired about the possibility of some training from our police department in which they could teach how you de-escalate a situation so that we don't even get to that point. So that's one point. I also wanted to say that it certainly is not unheard of that we establish a policy and then we go back and modify it. And I think I hear what you've said several times, and that is we are probably not only the school district, but students and parents are more at risk by having no policy than by having one that might have to be modified when additional guidelines come down. Is that what I hear you saying?
That is our concern, yes.
Okay.
Mr. Nichols.
In the definition of your definition of what it means to calm, disturbance is not necessarily uniform. I mean, I don't remember reading a definition of what that term means in the policy, right?
There's not a specific definition included in the policy.
I'm looking for a via media here, a middle way. Sorry, I use Latin. To address the issues, and realizing that we're going to have to revise this policy at the end anyhow. So is there some way to come to a better middle point in this issue, where maybe defining what quell, and or maybe defining what circumstances in which it shouldn't be used? And I still personally have a problem with the restraint issue as well. So I'm sympathetic to the plight of the individuals communicating with us.
Mr. Fuentes?
I want to thank the comments that we received from everybody on this, both tonight and in particular, there was one individual that had contacted me and actually articulated it in terms that I better understood, and then provided some reference material. So I had a little crash course this morning, very quickly looking at it. So I was trying to understand what the real concern was, and it really was coming down to just one or two things, and it was based on a couple things. One, they passed this law just recently, so I went and looked at the statute on that and read the law, and the law, as typical, is somewhat vague, but then it goes and directs the Board of Education to go off and develop some regulations. So that's supposed to happen within a year. Then there was another document from the COY, which I forgot what that stands for, but it's very clear in there that there was findings and recommendations. I'm sure you've seen it. And one of the concerns they had with the VSBA, it was specifically has needed to quell a disturbance. That was one of the specific ones that was in there. And their recommendation was hurry up and get your regulations out to kind of address that. So I'm kind of leaning with Mr. Nichols on what is the, I get it, we're going to have to revise this in a year, possibly. I agree that with Ms. Cardasco, no policy is worse than having a policy. Well, it can go both ways. A bad policy sometimes can not be good either. But I think this policy is very close to being very, very good. However, after that one has needed to quell a that one does kind of stand out, and it actually stands out in that document that I read from the COY, whatever those guys are from the state. That was
Commission on Youth.
What's that?
Commission on Youth.
The Commission on Youth. So it was an independent group from the state. I mean, it was a state group that put this together and made the recommendation. In fact, are they the ones that recommended the statute?
I don't know.
Well, anyway, they made that recommendation to go do that. So, and that was a concern. That was listed as one of the concerns, though. And I wish I had more time to go through all of it. But but what I'm hearing from everybody is basically that one in particular. I just feel if we strike it, the other ones kind of cover it. Everything else covers it. Am I wrong in the other bullets that you have? The other bullets that are listed,
correct.
All those kind of, kind of, address it.
Those tend to be more specific.
They tend to be more specific. That one tends to be the one that seems to be the. So I'm for kind of just deleting that one. And and move forward. But that's just my opinion.
Mrs. Cordasco?
Just wondered the comparison of policies that you put together, is that something that you plan to put out on the school website?
We can do that, yes.
I think it represents a substantial amount of research and work, and I think it's important that you do put it out there. I think that there's been an especial attention to detail in going through all of our policies this year. It's a lot of time, it's a lot of discussion, and I'm not certain that that's always understood by kind of the general person that's looking at the website. I think any kind of comparative document, like we did previously with our testing from school systems that were similar to us, I think that would be very helpful. And especially stood out to me the 15 school days in terms of the written notice timeline that most of them had adopted. And I know that when we had the discussion again in the policy, it was not to delay in letting the parents know. It was that sometimes gaining all the appropriate documentation from the involved parties took time to compile. So I appreciated the fact that we were, really trying to expedite that and to make parents aware, because it certainly isn't an easy notification to give, nor is it an easy one to hear.
Mrs. Cook.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to, whatever the board decides to do tonight, request that we, as soon as those VDOE regs are written, that we immediately revisit this so that we're in compliance with that. I'd also like to thank staff for their wonderful work on this. You were really cooperative and took a lot of time to not only do background research, but work cooperatively and with parents in the WJCC community. And thank you to all the parents who contributed and to SEAC. It was really incredible feedback, and it was, I think, I got to witness a pretty cool partnership, and I'm appreciative of that. So I'd like to offer an amendment that to the motion that we strike line 46. No?
Which is the what? I was
on page one.
Which is the quell disturbance?
As needed to quell a disturbance.
Okay.
Second.
I speak first?
Oh, I was seconding it. You can speak.
The mere title of this procedure, of this policy, just invokes bad mental images, and not something that we want to use. Obviously, this is a procedure, the policy that's going to be invoked well down the line after lots of other things are tried. So I just, and it's a very emotional subject, and it's something that just invokes a lot of negativity. Now, there were actually two lines, I think, that people came to me with concerns about. One was the quell of disturbance. The other one was the movement or actions of a student to avoid the undue or deliberate disruption of the learning environment. So when pen was put to paper, what was meant by intended for that sentence? Because it can be interpreted as overly broad for when you can use seclusion and restraint.
This would not be your typical classroom disruption or defiance. This would be when there is a really extensive disruptive movement going on. Again, these types of situations are often where it's in a large group and things are really becoming very fluid and can accelerate quickly. That would be an example of when that might happen.
Okay, so Is that redundant to as reasonably needed to prevent imminent destruction to school or another person's property, or
correct? Right.
Can we be more?
And it could be. It's you're trying to, in a succinct number of lines, try to capture as many possibilities as you can that in order to
I get it.
Garner it correctly.
And so as has been stated by Mrs. Cordasco, Mr. Fuentes, the absence of policy in this case we think is a risk to us, although there's a lot of other people that don't have a policy, but we think that
the absence of, we need to have a policy so that we can give guidelines for the use of seclusion and restraint tomorrow, soonly. So that's why we need to do this now versus when the state DOE comes out with their guidance.
That is the reason for the recommendation.
So then when they come out with their guidance in, they say a year or so, about two, then we have to come back and revisit this policy. So I guess what I would like, Mrs. Cook, is that if you want to take out both of those lines, amend your, can I do that as chair? I don't know if I can do that as chair.
The motion, the person who makes the motion and the person who seconds it can agree to the change.
Okay.
So I amend my amendment to remove line 46, page 1, which is as needed to quell a disturbance, and lines 55 and 56 on page 2, which state to direct the movement or actions of a student to avoid the undue or deliberate disruption of the learning environment.
You're amending your original motion.
Second. The second agrees to it.
The second agrees to that. So that's a new motion that we have on the, Mr. Parliamentarian?
So we have to vote on that.
Is there any further discussion about this policy? Okay, let me see if I can get this straight now. It has been moved and seconded for approval of policy JM, restraint and seclusion, as amended this evening. Is that where we are?
The
removal of those two statements.
4 and 55.
Yeah. Do I have to say any more than that?
Yes, just 45.
45.
Line
45. Line
46.
Line
46.
56.
55
and 56.
55
and
56. You got it, Ms. Serza?
I've got it.
Can you take the vote, please?
Mr. Fuentes.
Aye.
Ms. Larson.
Aye.
Mr. Nichols.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco.
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. 9.05.
May I just speak to 1 second, please? I just would ask that moving forward, in when you make your committee appointments, as those of you that are still here, you know, that this, the again, gets, you know, I hope someone will step in and take that SEAC role and work hard to be a liaison between the committee and the administration. Because it's an important committee.
There aren't many of us left.
Thank you.
Here.
Well, I see a couple faces out in the audience.
9.05, WJCC Schools Foundation donation for acceptance of the WJCC Schools Foundation donation for innovation learning grants. Can I have a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for approval of the WJCC Schools Foundation donation for innovation learning grants. Dr. Constantino.
Kelly, understanding that most of our agenda this evening may not have supported the holiday spirit, I put this last in hopes that we could get a little smile out of everybody. We're very pleased to ask you to accept $28,362 from the newly established WJCC School Foundations to support learning grants. Those grants, as you know, it's all done blindly, and the schools or the grantees don't even know who they are yet, but this is just so that the money can be distributed in January when that date comes.
Any discussion from board members?
Just very excited. Look forward to January 8th.
January 8th is the date that they
is that a secret?
Not anymore. It's not. Thank you, Mrs. Larson.
Was that a secret?
No.
Merry Christmas.
Nah. We're good.
I'm looking forward to January 8th because I'm going to breakfast that day.
Thank you, Mrs. Larson. Mr. Chair, I'd like to announce that on January 8th, awarding grants to schools.
Just didn't go that far.
Maybe the papers aren't paying attention at the moment. the funding for the raising of the money for the foundation, Dr. Constantino, can you give us a... Doc, Steve, are you listening to me?
I'm sorry.
You're not listening to me.
No, I'm not.
Okay. can you just give me a feel for how much of the 28,362 is in hand, or how much more money that there is in hand?
Foundation has funds in excess of 28,362. They have, I think it's a fair statement to say that they have approved the amount of money that they feel that they can afford with a very small operating budget to continue to go forward for the celebration and to go forward with the next year's campaign. So the vast majority of money that they've raised, they're turning right back around and giving to the schools.
Yeah, and they aren't releasing grants for the money that they have. They're releasing their grants for appropriate projects. They're not just
the programs committee of the Schools Foundation went through a blind process of evaluating all of the grants that were received. They made a determination on the grants that would be funded. They made a determination based on the funding they believed they would have available. Money continues to come into the WJCC Schools Foundation.
We can always use more.
And I was just
on January 8th.
On January 8th.
Shh.
For purposes of getting this done before the end of the fiscal year and being able to deliver those funds in January, this is the number that the foundation has given me to ask for your approval.
Great. Any comments from board members?
It's been moved and seconded for approval of the WJCC Schools Foundation donation for innovative learning grants in the amount of $28,362. Ms. Serza.
Ms. Larson.
Aye.
Mr. Nichols.
Aye.
Ms. Cook.
Aye.
Mrs. Cardasco.
Aye.
Ms. Emanuel.
Aye.
Mr. Fuentes.
Aye.
Mr. Kelly.
Aye. Thank you. 10.01, board members' comments. Since this is our last meeting of the year, we're going to do a little different. We're going to go in order of tenure, those who are staying, then those who are leaving. So, Ms. Cook, do you have anything that you want to say in summation of your year on the school board?
It's been fabulous. I wanted to mention that on Saturday, Centerra hosted the annual Sleigh Bell 5K, and there were over 1,200 runners there. More than half of them were affiliated with WJCC, and it was completely crazy, but in a good way. And a lot of people ran, and it was just fabulous to see that. The weather was good, too. I want to say thank you to Heather, Elise, Ruth, and Jim. It's been a pleasure working with you. And I'm glad we adopted a CIP. It's ours now, so let's go. Go team, let's go get that, let's go advocate for it. So anyway, thank you all.
Mr. Fuentes?
Regarding, I should have brought this up earlier, and I'm hoping in regards to the path from Lafayette to War Hill, I'm hoping that the administration might consider working with Parks and Rec. You know, when I saw that $1 million price tag or whatever for to put the path in, you know, I used the mountain bike trail back there, and maybe we should have a discussion with them of possibly that they can just do a leg off of that as a mountain bike trail. It's not actually a mountain bike trail. It's a little bit wider. It's used by joggers and walkers, but it's not a full multi-purpose path. So if we can get an improved path that just comes off, you know, I'm just looking for a cheaper alternative that maybe the Parks and Rec could do that brings it over to the high school.
And we certainly can do that. I would also offer for a suggestion to the board that this might be a topic for your joint meeting in March.
Good. Sure. Yeah. I just was, some idea, you know, because right now that's down there, that's 3 years from now, and it's down as $1 million. And as Ms. Cordasco said, once you start putting all these other requirements in, but somehow they got this other path that is pretty suitable, that goes all the way around, that is... It's not paved. It's a wide path for people to walk, jog, and all that. Maybe that's the $1 million, but I find that hard to believe. But anyway, just a suggestion of an approach.
Mrs. Cordasco.
Well, I just want to say thank you. It's been very enjoyable. A couple of things. I was up in Richmond all day judging the We the People constitutional competition, and we have actually had some teachers go through the training, but I don't think we've managed to field a team yet. And I would like to really encourage that we continue to look at that.
I also just want to, I'm just very pleased I was able to bring the idea of Manufacturing Day to our county and to the schools and to the other, to the attention of people. I was actually speaking to my brother who lives in another state, and he was telling me about a project that he needed to do on a building, and I said, you know, you should check with a couple of the high schools. Maybe there might be somebody who needs some intern hours that could be a part of it. And he said, oh, in our high schools, we're told that every child has to go to college in order for them to be a success. And as I've said repeatedly, I would never tell anyone not to go to college, but I might tell them not to go for 4 years right out of high school, especially if they're not sure what to do, and that there are wonderful jobs to be had. And so I would just very much say thank you to Dr. Constantino for saying yes to that, for Mr. Paolo, and for all of her help in that. Also for the North Star project that's becoming systemic. We are looking at all of our process, and that again was something that I brought, and I got a yes. And you can't move anything forward if you don't get a yes. And so we've saved money already, but more than that, we've begun to change the culture. And I'm very appreciative that those were yeses. Also think back to my very first tough budget on the board when we had to look at fifth grade music. And just one of those things I was very proud to advocate for, knowing how significant music and arts are and how many shows I've enjoyed. And I, you know, continue to say to people, if you don't come out and attend the performances, the band, the chorus, the plays, as well as our athletics, you are missing out. Because regardless of whether or not we have all the facilities we want to have, our students do world-class work. And so thank you for the yeses. Thank you for including the ideas that I've brought. And I will miss all of you.
Mr. Nichols.
Well, tonight's meeting is the conclusion of 8 years of service on the school board. I've enjoyed my time here. During the campaign, I was asked by a reporter what I thought about my opponent. And I responded that I'll let my opponent define him or herself. I will define myself. And, you know, as we look at the presidential candidates, one of the major flaws in politics, at least as far as I'm concerned, is that everybody's about defining somebody else, but they're not really defining themselves. So in defining myself this evening is I was and remain committed to the highest quality of public education for all children. So how did I wind up on the Williamsburg-James City School Board? Well, in 2007, after a number of people encouraged me to mount a write-in campaign for the school board, I replaced an incumbent who wound up being a write-in campaign too. What motivated me to run then and continues to motivate me and will motivate me continuing after I leave the board is that education of our children, of our community, is the most important priority that we can have. At the time, with the support of the board chair, which was Elise Emanuel, and Ruth Larson, Joe Fuentes, and Denise Cook, we started what was really called appreciative inquiry, although it wasn't really used then. And it really was a process of trying to look at what we value about our school division and about ourselves and the talents that each board member really brings to the school board. And it was through that process that we were able to soar. That is, we were able to work on our strengths. We looked at the opportunities that were available. We had aspirations for them. And we wanted to see results, all for the children. Even during a challenging economic downturn, with so many painful decisions that had to be made, our school division continued to make progress. All our schools are fully accredited and were fully accredited. Even when the rigor of the standard of learning tests increased, our on-time graduation rates are about 91% now, and we're slowly, and better than in the past, closing the minority achievement gap. All of these things and more were made possible by the commitment of our teachers, our support staff, school administrators, central office, parents, and community, and a school board that understood its proper role and responsibilities and were willing to cooperate and collaborate with one another and with the stakeholders.
During my service as a board member, we developed a standard operating procedure for the board, which defined the roles and responsibilities of board members. It contributed and continues to contribute to the smooth and effective functioning of the board. I was an advocate for developing a strategic plan, and while I was chair, I encouraged professional growth of the school board through professional reading. It's important to note that the statutes of the Commonwealth of Virginia even call for it. So it is important to be effective and innovative for the governance of our school division. And part of that is going to the Virginia School Boards Association meetings, participating in their hot topics, their webinars, attending the convention, and to attend the National School Boards Association's convention, and the National School Boards Federal Relations Network, which Ruth alluded to as being part of the whole process of talking about the needs of our school division to our legislators in Washington, D.C. I think as a side career, maybe as a major career, Ruth ought to think about becoming a lobbyist. As an elected or appointed member of the school board, we are expected to exercise our office in accordance with the Commonwealth statutes and federal law. And during my years on the board, I think I only missed three meetings. I've come to each meeting prepared to do the work of the board. I've participated in specially called meetings of the board, even during the Great Recession. I have offered my best for the children who are in and or have graduated, including my own, from the school division. It's been a lot of work. And after tonight's meeting, and I'm going on like this at 10, almost 10 after 10, but it's an important work. And the reward is not the $423 that I have received each month after taxes, but visiting our schools, seeing the faces of children who have made the connection in a math class, understood the reading assignment, completed a work of art to his or her satisfaction. or in music, watching them in the orchestra. And when we started the practice of recognizing students during our school board meetings, it was a great pleasure to see our students recognized for a team sport accomplishment, an honor student project, a theater or forensic accomplishment, or other achievements. I'm encouraged by the efforts not only of our current board, but also of boards, school boards around the country that are working to shift the paradigm from a 150-year-old educational system crafted for the industrial age to a model required for the age of technology. Forming independent opinions, critically evaluating the logic of others, communicating, collaborating, solving problems creatively, and synthesizing. After 13 years of No Child Left Behind, it is clear that the effort to educate children by testing is not working, and I'm glad that the new reauthorization was signed. In fact, while we laud the successes of our students in investing most of the Commonwealth and nation on our SAT scores and AP exams, they aren't helping our children to learn and be equipped for a different market today. That's why I'm encouraged by the school division's partnership with William and Mary School of Education, made possible from a $50,000 grant from the state, one of only five school divisions to receive such a grant, in order to redesign the high school curriculum to equip our high school students with the requisite skills and competencies for the 21st century economy and society. A major component of preparing students for tomorrow's job market is the new middle school. And contrary to what I heard this evening, I don't think that the vote was a mandate on the middle school. There are other factors in play besides just that. The conversations, discussions about the middle school took place during the course of nearly 5 years. The school board asked the county and city to do a demographic study in order to determine where the growth would be. The study pointed to the Blair site as an excellent location, while some may still doubt that. The county would not have purchased the land. They didn't have to do that. The county would not have to do an impact study or run water, gas, or sewer lines. And the preliminary renderings of the school's footprint, as we even saw this evening, indicate that the traffic flow around the school will work. While the school board recommended the middle school be built in one phase, the Board of Supervisors, because of fiscal constraints of the time, had to decide to move in two phases. When the school is built out, it will have a capacity of more than 900 students. The school will be designed to support the requirements of public education in a technological age rather than an industrial one. The middle school concept and location was vetted by a committee of 15 community members, numerous faculty and staff, the Williamsburg City Council, the Board of Supervisors, the Williamsburg-James City School Board, and the public. With Matthew Whaley exceeding capacity, with Stonehouse almost at capacity, with Berkeley Middle School exceeding capacity, and with Tuano Middle School exceeding capacity, our children need a middle school now. It's been a distinct honor to serve on this board. Williamsburg-James City County School Division is blessed to have Dr. Constantino and Dr. Heron at its helm. We have dedicated members of the leadership team. We have deeply committed teachers in our classrooms who spend countless hours in preparation to engage students in learning and communicate and collaborate with parents and guardians. We have an outstanding support staff who give their best to make the children the center of all they do. The successes that our students enjoy are attributed to all of you. I applaud you and I thank you. At the recent Virginia School Boards Association convention at the Williamsburg Lodge, Rory Vadden, the author of two books, the most recent one being Take the Stairs, Seven Steps to Achieving Success, said, "Success is never owned, it is rented, and the rent is due every day." The success of our school division depends upon the rent. That rent is due every day by each board member committing his or her time, talent, and treasure in preparation for the meetings, in professional development, in visiting the schools, attending events and functions, and collaborating with one another, and being respectful of each other. The focus must be on the students, not on the board, but what's best for them. Thank you for your service on the board. Thank you for all that you do. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nichols. Ms. Larson?
Thank you very much. First, I want to thank my mom and my son for sticking here the whole time. This is the latest meeting we've had in a while. I just wanted to say that I got involved really because of Rob. I wanted to ensure that the people who were responsible for spending almost as much time with him as I did were being supported in the best way possible by their citizens. And so it was very important for me to take that step in the PTA journey, and then it led me here to the school board. The support that I have received from my colleagues here has been tremendous. It has been a pleasure working with all of you, and you have each brought unique talents, and also the people that came before you, Mary Ann, John, Denise, Ron, Oscar. I hope I didn't leave anybody else out. That's why I shouldn't have started naming names. I'm very proud of the work that we've done here through good times and tough times. I wanted to also thank you all for the support that I received from you all as I pursued leadership positions with the VSBA. It was an honor, and I know that it took a lot, so thank you all very much for that. I am so appreciative of everyone in this school division. I don't even know where to start. Operations, support staff, teachers, principals, all of you and the work that you do every day. It's outstanding. Our students, the reason that we're here, we are so blessed with 11,000 students that we have and the hard work that they put in to make to do their best every day as well. Dr. Constantino, thank you for coming to Williamsburg, James City County. You've taught me a lot, and I appreciate that. Janet, all the support that you have provided. I just really want to thank you. It's late. I had a lot more written, but I certainly know that you all don't want to sit in here and listen to me any longer, so I'll just wrap up. And thank you for the outstanding education that has been and will continue to be provided for all students, but particularly on behalf of Craig and I. Thank you for what you do every day and what you have done for Rob and what you will do for Caroline and Abby. My cup runneth over. Thank you.
Mrs. Emanuel.
Well, it's tough to be last after all of that, but
I got that.
well over 60 years ago, there was a girl who didn't have a very good day in sixth grade. And as she was wont to do, she just walked around the neighborhood, kept walking and kept walking. And then all of a sudden, at the corner of Warren and South Cook in Denver, so when you go to Denver, you can see exactly where this happened, came to me. I know what I'll do. I'll become a teacher and make life better for all the kids who come after me. Now, as I look at this room, you are all the kids who've come after me. So it's time, really, for me to say goodbye. I appreciate so much. When I first came to Williamsburg, there were 3,000 kids in the school district. And that was some time ago. But we only had two or three schools, Matthew Whaley, Norge, Rawlsburg, Berkeley, and James Blair, five schools. So you've really gone a long way. I've always believed in the potential of this community and the potential of our schools. We've always had good teachers. We've always had some who had a little problems. But by and large, we've had a really good system going way back to when there were only 3,000 kids. In the old days, I used to have to keep a register with the Williamsburg kids' names and the James City County kids, and you had to add up all. It was really like an accounting process. But so, you know, it's been a lot different with the computers and all of that kind of stuff. But we've always had potential, and we still have potential. I've had two opportunities to chair search committees for superintendent, and I want you to know that I think we've done a better job this time than the first. Anyway, it's I really appreciate everything that everybody's done to make this such a good school system. A couple of things that I worry about, and one is that the recession stalled some progress for us, so I'm concerned that we need to get that back. I think teacher pay has slipped. There's now a beginning of a teacher shortage. I hope we're really staying on top of that. And I'm concerned about early childhood, and I hope we can add more to early childhood so that we can make all of the children ready for school when it's time. With that, I say goodbye. Thank you all for your time and attention, and I love you all.
Mr. Kelly, I'm sorry, I forgot one thing. I wanted to say that I wish Mrs. Taylor the best of luck as she takes this seat, and all of the new members, really, and you all moving forward. So,
and allow me to say that my replacement is in the audience, Julie Hummel.
Welcome.
One of the pleasures of working on the school board is meeting and working with great people, whether it's being the administration, the teachers that we have in the classroom, or the seven of us that are up here. Just a wonderful group of people up here. I want to thank Mrs. Cordasco for serving as vice chair this past year. I have valued your opinion and your thoughts, and I appreciated you stepping up to take that role. It has been my honor to serve as chair and to work with all of you, the six others besides me, I guess, up here, and the administration. We have a great school system as a result of your work. We have done a lot of great work, and we've had some great experiences. We have disagreed, we have agreed, we have discussed and modified. We have made easy decisions, and we have made tough decisions. We all come from different backgrounds and different ideologies, but we have always worked together with trust, civility, and respect to do what is right for public education. We have done well. Thank you for your good work, your guidance to me personally, and your service to this community. The new seven who will be up here in January have a high bar to clear because of the work of us. So it's been a pleasure to serve with all of you. With that, we go to 11.01, upcoming meetings, January 5th, 2016, 6:00 p.m. We have a closed session here in Building F in the county complex. January 15th at 6:30, we will meet here in this room for an organizational meeting and work session with action items. On January 19th at 6:00, we'll be here for closed session.
January 19th at 6:30, we'll have a public hearing on the proposed 2017 budget here in Building F, with a regular meeting to follow immediately thereafter. And on February 9th at 6 o'clock, here in Building F, we'll have closed session and work session and action items to follow at 6:30 on February 9th. With that, we will go into recess to go back into closed session. Thank you all.